all our participants and all our speakers who've joined us already for the webinar. On behalf of, let me introduce myself first. I'm Rachita from SELCO Foundation, and I'll be your host today for the webinar for the next 3 hours. On behalf of SELCO Foundation, as well as our co-hosts and partners, Public Health Foundation of India, Healthcare Without Harm, Shakti Foundation, and Center for Chronic Disease Control, I'd like to welcome all of you and thank you so much for your time for this webinar titled Responding to COVID-19 by Strengthening the Health Infrastructure and Systems in Low-Resource Settings. So the next three sessions, we will be discussing some of the best practices, the insights that are coming from the ground, the learnings that are coming from the ground from various levels. In the first session specifically, which will be soon starting, scheduled for about an hour, we will have some insights from key stakeholders who are mostly working at a national level and trying to understand from them what are the learnings coming from different parts of the country, efforts that are being taken at multiple levels to either as a response to COVID-19 or to mitigate and trying to improve the resilience at a more regional level as well. And session two and three will be hearing more from the practitioners. So one round would be voices of NGOs, health practitioners, and the third session would be specifically hearing from government officials or representatives who are working in independent capacity with the multiple task forces that have been set up at the state level on, again, how they have been dealing with some of the infrastructure gaps, what are, again, some of the learnings that they are having, and how are they even coping with it right now, what are some of the strategies that they're adopting right now, but also some of the things that they're reflecting on how we can strengthen our health infrastructure across the board, even going beyond COVID-19. So we are able to deal with such a pandemic in a better, in a more resilient manner the next time, and hopefully there won't be a next time at all. So thank you again to all our participants. One quick thing I would like to say before we start. We have a small, you will see a Q&A button at the bottom of your Zoom screen. We realize that there is a really good attendance here from health practitioners, from NGOs, and we would really want you to interact with the speakers here. Put down any questions, any thoughts, any comments that you might have, and please use the Q&A button for that. In addition to that, we will be recording this session, so we will be able to share this with you as a link later on, along with some of the key points that were discussed today. So we will be sharing that soon after this webinar gets over. So with that, we'd like to start off with the first session. And to start off the first session, I'd like to invite the founder and CEO of SELCO Foundation, Dr. Harish Hande, for a welcome address, as well as to start off with the first session itself. Thank you, Harish. Over to you.
Thanks, Rachita. Thanks to all for coming to this webinar. To give a context, people have been asking why SELCO and the partners have been doing it. So we've been in the field of energy access, and for us, for many years, we were looking at climate change, poverty as an existential crisis. And we believe that there had to be, the society had to build up resilience, and especially for the poor who do not have any form of a net or a safety net. And we believe that there was a very strong linkage. If the poor had to get out of poverty in a very sustainable manner, you had to have better health, you had to have better access to income generation, education, and all the basic needs that a lot of us have actually taken it for granted. But this is actually, this crisis, COVID-19, has actually opened the wounds that many of us while have the luxury of lockdown or stay at home, because we have got enough of social security behind us. See, our primary question to many of us is, when will the lockdown so we'll get back to office? The way the WhatsApp messages are being shared in terms of the lighter banter, what we are doing at home, or how are we missing office, etc. We have the luxury to do that. Many of us do not have, as citizens of the world, do not have the luxury to do that. This crisis, in many ways, will actually be a wake-up call is a wake-up call for a lot of us, saying that at least in this case, we could come up with one way, saying that stay at home. A climate crisis, which is also looming very largely, where there's nothing called as stay at home. You cannot either stay inside or stay outside, whether it's floods, whether it's typhoons, whether it's droughts. But it's all so interlinked. It's extremely interlinked. COVID-19 is actually a wake-up call. It's not not only a pandemic that we all say it's a once in a century, but it's also a wake-up call to humanity in many ways. So I'm so glad that we have some brilliant speakers who have come to us, come to this webinar today. It also shows us that the interest, but also I would like to tell to all our participants that we really want to make this webinar an interactive, where we are saying that it's not something that, okay, how do we come up with solutions, immediate solutions for COVID-19? How do we learn very strongly from this? Build resilient systems in healthcare. The other NGOs who are working in the field of education, in the field of livelihoods, in the field of poverty, in the field of climate change, can also learn and realize that this is not the only pandemic that we would be facing. So to start off, that we have very eminent three speakers in our first session, who are at the heart of what's going on, who have been advising the government, who have been bringing out absolutely relevant statements in the public of how to deal with it. And so let's hear from them. And what can we all learn from what they are experiencing, so that in the crisis that we all will be facing one way or the other, we will learn from and create those appropriate processes. And so that the poor, especially the poor, I'm not talking of poor in India itself, the poor around the world, whether the poor is in Paris, Chicago, or in Mumbai, or in central part of Africa, we could have processes that they do not have to go through this. So let me first invite Dr. Srinath Reddy. Our first panelists are Dr. Srinath Reddy, who is the president of the Public Health Foundation of India, Dr. Prabhakaran, who is the head of the Center for Chronic Disease Control in New Delhi, and Dr. Alexander Thomas, who is the executive director of the Association of Healthcare Providers of India. Thank you so much to all of you for joining us in the first session. First, let me start with Dr. Srinath Reddy, who's eminent, who's the visiting professor of cardiac health at the Harvard School of Public Health from 2009 to 2013. And he serves as the adjunct professor of epidemiology at Harvard. Multiple accolades. He's presently the member of the government established high-level technical committee of public health experts for COVID-19. Sir, you are at the heart of it right now. And we've read a lot of the statements that you have made, which is what is providing a lot of security for citizens in terms of, yes, we are taking the right steps as a country. Sir, over to you. Your views. Where are we going right? Where are we going wrong? What are the others who can learn from a crisis like this? Over to you, sir.
Well, this has been a major challenge to the health system as well as our social systems. And the neglect that our health system has had over the years, with lower levels of public financing, poor buildup of primary health care, both in rural and in urban areas, as well as the great inequalities in terms of health system development between states and between districts, has actually begun testing our response. And we now recognize that there is a much greater awareness that the kind of attention they needed. Because in an emergency, it is very difficult to suddenly build a surge capacity all of a sudden. You need to have an efficient, steady state functioning of the health system if you have to suddenly build in a surge capacity. Having said that, there is still a fairly commendable response that has happened across the country, both in terms of the pre-lockdown steps of trying to reduce international travel and progressively reduce the kind of dissemination that occurs because of crowding through social distancing measures, and then finally leading up to the lockdown. The lockdown, of course, serves the purpose of trying to disrupt the chain of transmission. It cannot be complete, but at least substantially effective. But more important, it also gives the health system and the social systems greater time to prepare for the post-lockdown release so that we can respond with much greater efficiency and empathy. Unfortunately, there have been some slippages. The way actually the migrant workers have unfortunately not found shelter or support in the immediate aftermath of the lockdown is again a poor reflection of our system, particularly of urban primary healthcare and urban social systems. But despite all the complaints that we are seeing about inadequate testing and so on, the number of serious respiratory infections being admitted into the hospitals is still low, which suggests that at least our control measures seem to be effective, or the virus is not spreading as fast as expected, or that the virus could be milder. We do not know yet, but certainly we need to ramp up our preparation in the time that the lockdown is allowed, and we will have to continue our efforts undiluted even after the lockdown ends.
So to continue on that, sir, according to you, should we increase the period of lockdown, looking at what's happening in the United States, Spain, France, who have got it, I mean, especially in the state of New York and New Jersey, who has got it out of control? Should we increase those lockdown according to what you just said?
Well, to give you more time. Well, even Singapore, which had a very good public health response and appeared to be in full control of the epidemic, has gone into a month-long lockdown. So the idea here is that we must give ourselves enough time to interrupt the chain of transmission. But I would suggest that the lockdown cannot be uniform all across the country. While some measures of social distancing and lockdown will have to be maintained, we can have a partial release in some areas which are relatively unaffected, but they should continue to be protected. The rural areas, for example, which have to undertake farming activity, may have to undertake that, but with urban to rural transmission of the virus strictly controlled with effective movement regulation of people as well as goods. And similarly, if we do a very quick district-wise random sampling to find out who are the asymptomatic as well as symptomatic cases, and improve house-to-house surveillance through frontline health workers, we may be able to identify, again, which are the hot zones that need to be completely circumscribed, the warm zones which require to be under close surveillance with some limited economic activity and movement, and the relatively safe zones where much more liberally the movement can be permitted within those zones. I think, therefore, we need to have not a one-size-fits-all response, but somewhat of a nuanced response across the country.
Thank you, sir. I'll come back to you with more questions and pertinent to environmental health and how a country like ours can not only build those resilience, and then how can we be a learning bed for the other countries in Africa, especially the South, the Africa and in Latin America. So can I move on to Dr. Prabhakaran, who is presently the Executive Director for Center for Chronic Disease Control. And you're also leading the technology division for COVID-19 in PHFI. So sir, from your perspective, the technology has been a buzzword in terms of lack of ventilators. We need to have low-cost ventilators. We need to innovate on more ventilators across the world. there has been a mass call. There's a push. What do you think should have been the basic ecosystem that should have been created so that at least we would not face similar issues in the future? And before that, yes, your views on the plus and minuses and segueing into the technology part of it also, sir. Dr. Prabhakaran. So you're on mute, sir.
Sorry.
Yeah.
So first of all, I would like to thank Rachita and Mr. Hande and SELCO Foundation for inviting me to say something on this aspect. You said that I wear two hats, one in Public Health Foundation of India and the other in Center for Chronic Disease Control, but I would like to wear three other hats as a concerned clinician, as a cardiologist, and wear a common sense hat and say what needs to be done, what are we doing. So I think I'm going to talk on three or four things. One is what are the technological solutions that we are looking at? Second is to look at the healthcare paradigm changes that are occurring and how can we actually position ourselves as we move along the COVID pandemic as well as the post-COVID era, and look at some of the new and emerging areas. These are the three things I would like to talk about. Now, the problem of COVID has been highlighted. We all know it's a big problem. And it is going to potentially overwhelm the health systems. It is already done in many countries like Italy, United States, and others. But what are the innovative solutions that we have? So the potential areas that we are working on at the Public Health Foundation of India is to look at, how do we trace these migrants who have gone back to their villages? How do we actually identify their contacts, their relationships, their where they are, because they are very, very migratory and they could spread the infection. So our group has been working on creating an app which is GPS enabled and which can have a rapid tracking system, which can track the symptoms and identify people as soon as possible based on clinical criteria. This is under testing and may take a few days actually for it to be released. Already there is this COVID Setu or the app which the government has, so it will be complementary to that and add additional things to it. Then there is this home intelligence based screening handheld device, so you could go to houses and rapidly screen people and look at whether they have fever, whether they have symptoms, and it has again can give you cluster trends, and it can be used by village level workers and grassroots workers, because I think we cannot use the Western model or the even the South African model where we are using, you know, highly trained healthcare workers to identify people. So we need actually to get to the grassroots and to the people who are really in the field and identify people who have symptoms. The third area that we are working on is to get rapid diagnostic tests. At this point of time, I just would like to diverge and tell this audience that there are two types of tests. One is where we try and identify the viral markers itself or the viral products or antigens. And the other one is how our body reacted to this infection, which produces antibody. Now, both have a big role. The antigen will identify people with the infection. There are limitations to it, but it is extremely useful. This is what South Korea did and others did. But even Japan did the same, and the effects were nearly similar in terms of mortality and in terms of spread. So we need to really ration that and do it in the right manner, I think, which the government is also doing. But beyond that, I think we need to move forward into getting antibody tests, which actually denotes past infections, so that you can release these people into the system. I mean, they're not going to infect others. The chances of them getting reinfected, I mean, in the current state of knowledge, it appears to be low, though many people say that there can be a recurrence, but that's extremely low. So these people can be left into the system so that we don't shut down completely, and we need to rapidly develop the antibody system. So we have developed a point of care device called Fastest Hack, which was originally used in antenatal care and is likely to be used in that subsequently, but we are trying to add a test to that, and this will take some time because we are looking at specific tests which are more robust on that. This may take around 4-5 weeks time to get. Then the third thing that we're doing is mathematical modeling. Our teams are working with the National Center for Disease Control, several state governments, including Orissa, Telangana, Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka, and several other states, UP, for example, where we're providing projections on a day-to-day basis based on available data and telling the governments exactly where they should intervene, what are the hotspots, what are the infrastructure that is needed, and so on and so forth. the last thing that the other thing that we should work on is disinfectants on a mass scale. How do we disinfect malls? How do we disinfect hospitals? How do we disinfect work sites? And our group is working on rapidly disinfecting something like a 50,000 square feet space using a combination of systems like ultraviolet light, hot air, and the isopropyl alcohol based disinfectants in a combination. And how do you do it rapidly? So that is being tested. The second thing that is being tested is the personal protection devices, such as creating masks which are equal to N95, but which can be reused and which can be rapidly scaled up and tested across the used across the country. So these are some of the things that we are working on. But I think one of the areas which you rightly pointed out is personal protection devices and ventilators, for example. The question is, what do we do with ventilators? Do we need more ventilators? I think we should wait for some time, because the pathogenesis of this disease is unraveling very rapidly. And there are recent attempts to look at whether ventilatory support is the only thing that is going to be helpful, or are we going to look at the role of oxygen, higher oxygen levels, and blood transfusions, hematin, and other things, because the pathogenesis appears to be evolving and is somewhat different. So this is as regards to COVID is concerned. The other big problem that is emerging is people who naturally would have got healthcare for other problems are not getting healthcare currently, because I think everybody is concentrating on COVID. And I would like to give two personal examples. One of my uncles passed away yesterday for a very simple problem. He was 90 years plus. He had diarrhea. And I think there were no hospitals which were taking him. They went to a smaller hospital. And I think he died of electrolyte imbalance, low potassium, because he dehydrated so badly that they couldn't even give him IV fluids. You know, that's the kind of problem that is arising. And I think we need to protect other citizens who do not have COVID-like infections. And many times, other important and difficult diagnoses are missed because there has been excessive focusing on COVID, but neglecting other diseases which may be very similar to COVID. The third idea that I wanted to talk is futuristic. What are the changes in healthcare paradigm that is happening? One is, I think we need to create e-learning platforms. PHFI is working on that, AIIMS is working on that, and several other groups are working, and the PHFI team is working on providing information to a big database of primary care physicians that we have in terms of how to manage, what are the issues with relation to COVID, how do we actually prioritize people, and so on and so forth. The second thing that is going to happen is the role of telehealth and teleconsultation, which is going to come up in a big way. And particularly here, I touch upon what Dr. Reddy said, that it's very important. We have been talking about this task sharing and task shifting, but it has been ignored substantially in the past. But I think it is going to come back, where we can enable this primary healthcare workers or nurses with electronic decision support system for a variety of diseases, which we have a lot of experience with. And we are testing out some of those in states like Tripura and in private hospitals in Ludhiana. And if we show that it works, I think we can actually declutter our hospitals. Not many of our patients who have chronic conditions need to come to the hospitals, and they can be managed on a long-term basis by these healthcare workers. I mentioned about treating people with existing illness, but I think we need to give attention to new therapies. I spoke about ventilator versus oxygen, new drugs like blood hematin, new actions of chloroquine. These are all required to be thought of. Finally, we require some innovations in data management. We need to harness machine learning and artificial intelligence to look at integrated cloud-based repositories from combining data from multiple sources, an online platform for epidemiological tracking, both the progress and the interventions, and multidimensional analysis of patients. These are some of the things that we need to do. And finally, I think we require to look at social determinants and what happens to these, the interaction of socioeconomic class and education and poorer patients, what happens to them. I think this, we need some kind of innovation to look at very closely. I think this, in summary, is what I wanted to say.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Prabhakaran. I will come back to you more on the future of what do we learn from here, the future of technology in low resource settings, and especially related to both environment and health. So moving on to Dr. Alexander, sir, you've been very instrumental in the bringing out the patient-centric Clinical Establishment Act in Karnataka, and you've been and also looking at how do you engage the insurance companies and etc. You've been pushing those. Can you? And today there's a debate that the US is not doing well because it relied too much on the private sector, while many of the European countries are doing much better because of the public push on public health being a public good and by public by the government. Could you touch upon that? Is that is something that from your own background and what should we be doing and the role of private hospitals? So you're on mute, sir. Dr. Alexander, sir.
Thank you, Harish, and thank you for inviting me. I'll quickly go through, especially with this COVID in the background. As you all know, the HPI has chapters all over the country, and we've been meeting regularly twice a week for the last 3 or 4 weeks. And basically, I'll focus on that and maybe what you said a little later. So I think earlier, was it yesterday that we had a Zoom call with colleagues in the National Security Council. And I think they put it very aptly. COVID is like a terrorist. It hides in the community, attacks vulnerable in the community, divides society. But unfortunately, it's got a very high attack rate. So we have to keep that in mind. And also, I think the battlefield is now moving from the community into the hospitals. Because now is where phase two of it will start, where patients start getting admitted. And we will have to got up for that. And basically, as a clinician, I do understand that it is, in the words of one of our very senior colleagues in the Home Ministry, it's a balance between the health aspects and the economy. The question is if the person dies of hunger or he dies of the disease. So keeping that in mind, I just very briefly tell you what has happened over the last 3 or 4 weeks. I think on the whole, the government has done a commendable job. They have involved in most states, they have involved the private sector. There have been public-private partnerships, especially in the state of Karnataka, right from the fever clinics to quarantine to the hospitals. And I think a big one big decision that I think the private sector had a role to play in was the decision in setting up dedicated COVID hospitals. Because I remember the first couple of weeks when this came out, many states were asking private hospitals to keep 10, 15 beds in the hospital. And we repeatedly brought to them the example of Italy, where 40% of the patients who didn't have COVID were infected because of this mixing up. And I'm glad that the health secretary sent a letter to all the states saying that please have a separate system. And I think the separate COVID system with separate dedicated hospitals has made a big difference, will make a big difference. The lockdown, there was another area where we strongly recommended that there be a three-week lockdown. There was a lot of bureaucratic resistance to that, but I'm glad the president finally took a decision and the states are now realizing how useful it was. It has, I'm sure, it has reduced and will reduce the transmission significantly. Quickly, I think just briefly the learnings. And Rachita, just tell me when I'm due to close. Give me 2 or 3 minutes notice and I'll wind up because I need to be sensitive with the others. I think one of the things that we need to be aware of is that the awareness about the disease needs to be widespread if you have something like this in future. I think the lockdown has added to the awareness. There was a lot of issues, stigma to the medical professionals, and this had to be dealt with at the highest level. The Prime Minister had to intervene because all over the country, we got reports. Our state presidents told us that nurses were being asked to vacate, DNB students were being asked to vacate their homes. And I think that is better. And I think here the media has a role to play. Instead of looking at TRPs, et cetera, I think they play a very important role in awareness of social distancing, hygiene, et cetera. And I think communication strategy is very important. It shouldn't be us versus them. I think we are all in it together as a nation and we need to work together. As was mentioned earlier, I think every cloud has a silver lining and we've been trying to get telemedicine legalized for 2 or 3 years. It was not possible. But because of this, we were able to influence the MCI. And I think that will make a big difference. It will help the optimum use of scarce health resources in the future. Testing was mentioned earlier. I think in the future, after the lockdown, it is absolutely aggressive testing and contact, like the example in Kerala. I think Srinath has repeatedly said that. And I was actually in interaction with Indian Institute of Science and NCBS, and they have suggested a pool testing. They have something called a combinational pool testing, so they will be able to find out if samples are taken from a certain area, the incidence, whether it's high or low, and then you can proceed on that. Now, the other problem is the availability of PPEs, and again, universally in throughout the country, all our states, this was a big problem, and I think it's unfair to send our frontline workers into battle without these. Government has assured us, they said that everything has come and we'll have to access it. I hope that's true. Now, in the rural areas, I think the problems are a little different. Today morning, I was having a conversation with an expert. He says, what are you talking about social distancing and hand washing? It just won't work in the villages. Every village has one borewell, so you can't talk of a dispenser, you can't talk of soap. So I think that is something that we have to address. Also, in the next stage where hospital patients are going to come to hospitals, I think in the cities it's all right. We have government hospitals, private setups who will be able to handle it. But what about the districts? Government of India has suggested that district hospitals be used. But I think all of us know the situation. Most of the district hospitals have 70 to 80% vacancy in specialists. They have just nurses in the ratio of 1:30. No paramedical support. So what we have suggested to the government, at least in Karnataka and most of the states, every district has a medical college. So the private medical colleges can be taken over and be used for this, and they are considering it. Also, one of the other things we have noticed that every state has a different methodology in taking over institutions. In Orissa, I think it's all very straightforward. They take over a hospital, they have an MOU. But in other states like Telangana, they've just taken over the hospital. Nobody knows what's going to happen. Is the government going to staff? Is the government going to pay the electricity, et cetera, et cetera. Having said that, I think in the country as a whole, as Srinath has repeatedly been saying, I think we need to focus on our PHCs as the first line. And I think that is something that we need to really look at this time. Instead of just being theoretical, we need to put that in practice. Long term, there are a lot of other things that I would, I won't focus on that. But yes, one is how we can increase the number of human resources. Very importantly, I think we need to change our ratio. At the moment, it's 70% private and 30% public. I think it should be the other way. Focus on high quality public institutions and make sure that there is a balance. And I think in many areas, we depend too much on the private sector. Now, coming to the next stage where the battle is going to be fought in the hospitals, I think it's very, very crucial that the morale of the frontline workers is kept high and that we protect them. The government recently announced an insurance, life insurance policy, but it's still not clear whether it's only for the government workers or for the private sector. We have spoken to the health secretary and to CK Mishra. Hopefully it will cover all the workers because it is a battle that we are doing together. Testing, just to reiterate, that testing has to be done, especially for our frontline workers. PPEs and medicines, I think there should be no question that of the availability of this to those who are in the forefront. And like in Delhi, I think we have to focus on the safety of the families of the medical professionals where they've taken hotels. Doctors finish their, go to a hotel, come back, finish their term there, and then after quarantine, go back to the houses. And I think you also need to ensure that we have adequate human resources to ensure that there is no burnout of nurses, doctors, and paramedicals, that they work adequately and give their full output and we protect them. Now, another area of concern, and this is what I want to focus on this, is I think Prabhakaran mentioned it, the non-COVID patients in the country are facing a huge, huge problem. They're not able to access hospitals. There are three reasons. One is there is a lockdown. Two is the government has given orders that no elective and no OPDs. Three, there is a huge fear factor because normal patients are under the impression that all the hospitals are full of COVID patients. this step of having separate COVID system with a separate dedicated COVID hospitals, I think that will make a difference. But I think the media and all of us need to encourage our patients to come to hospitals. Because as the examples mentioned, I think there are thousands of patients who are dying at home, thousands of patients who are becoming very ill because they have no access to the hospitals. Now, I think the other aspect of this, the patients not going to private hospitals, is that the viability and existence of hospitals is in jeopardy. And this is not only the small nursing homes and mid-sized hospitals, it's even big hospitals, big mission hospitals, and across the board. There are no patients, income has gone down, no elective surgeries, no OPDs. Occupancy is around 10 to 20%, OPD has come down to about 5%. And many, many hospitals are having cash flow problem. They don't have money. And they said they could hold out for another 3 or 4 weeks. Nothing is on the way, that they will have to close down. And I think it's important that the government realizes this, because you may tell me that every sector has this problem. It's not only medicine. The farmers have it, the hotel industry. But I think we need to remember, in fighting this pandemic, the hospitals and the medical workers in the private sector also are in the forefront and very pivotal in this battle. So if we damage that, and if we do not take care of this, the battle will not be, it definitely will be affected, and we would have problems. Having said this, we have already appealed to the union government, and a few things have been done. They have instructed immediately the ECHS and CGHS just to be released. They have ensured some of our HP members are trying to import material in to get PPEs. They have said there are no customs duties. We have asked, they have also said they look into giving all the tax refunds. We have asked them for electricity and water, some sort of a subsidy. And I think most of the hospitals feel that if the government doesn't chip in and help out with the salaries, that they would be in big trouble. Particularly, I think want to say that this is a situation where most of us haven't seen in our lifetime, and we need to put everything that we have together and fight this pandemic together. Prepare for the worst, but we hope for the best. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Doctor. I will get back to you with the other question regarding the US versus Europe a little more. But let me get to Dr. Srinath. Sir, you eloquently said about the infrastructure, which we have been speaking about from years. And if also I would tie in the whole the climate change as well issue into it. See, a lot of us also realize that a lot of the people who have come to the to urban areas for work over the last two, three decades, especially in the last two decades, have been because of climate-related issues in the rural areas. The droughts, the floods, have led to lack of income-generating activities in the rural areas. The farming sector has taken a beating. The droughts have led to a lot of people in central Maharashtra moving away into Mumbai, in Gulbarga, coming to Bangalore. People have to... Now saying that, okay, we are having a reverse migration, might be good, but have to realize that a lot of poor are stuck between the devil and the deep blue sea. I mean, it's like they have nowhere to go. I mean, what do you have? You go back. So I think we... As a country, as citizens of the world, I'm not looking at India itself, which is a migrant issue in Africa also. Isn't it right time for us to use this opportunity to create all the basic infrastructure so strong in the rural areas that we create a decentralized approach to development? And this, I mean, can health sector take that lead of pushing off, okay, yeah, so we can actually create islands of development that becomes so that we don't need these issues of migrants, so that the best safety net that we can create in terms of decentralization is for the poor, and could health sector take the lead, sir?
Certainly, I believe it's absolutely essential that we develop our rural areas, both economically as well as in terms of healthcare infrastructure, so that this kind of urban congestion does not take place. And we have recognized that zoonotic diseases actually do arise from a lot of unregulated deforestation, particularly for peri-urban growth. And even otherwise, we recognize there are so many other common links between the origins of zoonotic diseases and climate change, which we need to control. And certainly, I believe it is also very important for us to ensure that simultaneously with strengthening of rural infrastructure, especially healthcare infrastructure, but also economic opportunities, we also provide a corrective to the kind of haphazard urban growth and automobile density and other conditions which have also led to climate change. So while addressing through the health sector lens, what should be an altered development paradigm, we can actually answer some of the issues related to climate change, but also tackle fundamentally some of the reasons why zoonotic diseases have become much more common in the last half century. So it's an entirely a distorted development paradigm that has led to both climate change and zoonotic diseases like Corona. So we need to tackle all of that. But it's very clear that the focus on our economic growth has been much more urban oriented with a great deal of rural neglect. And along with that developmental neglect, the health system also, despite having a primary care health infrastructure as a part of the design, still was not adequately financed, not adequately staffed, not adequately governed. And therefore, the rural healthcare and district hospital level healthcare have both been major casualties of this kind of a distorted pattern of development. We do need to apply the correctives in a big manner. Having said that, I believe urban migrants also need much better protection if they are going to be in urban areas with better healthcare facilities, with absolutely caring and compassionate extension of health services through a good urban primary healthcare system. And they need a social protection system as well, which will not leave them to their fate whenever an epidemic breaks out.
Thank you, Dr. Srinath. I also request my colleagues, Rachita, if I will come to Dr. Nandkumar and Dr. Reggie, whom I hear are on, also online. So it would be good to hear from them in right at the heart in the rural areas, what's happening a bit. And before I start the questions from the audience. So Dr. Prabhakaran, has he stepped out?
Sorry, I got disconnected because the electricity.
Thank you, sir. As you're talking of electricity, sir, and what Dr. Srinath said, isn't it high time that as a country we push for innovations in technology in rural resource settings? Today, Dr. Prabhakaran, it's like a couple of years or 3 or 4 years ago, I had met the vice president of GE of medical devices. And one of the most surprising statements that he made was, we don't look at efficiency, our energy efficiency. So it was more about how do I add another value add? So into the dental chair and all value add. So it's all about what the middle class and rich want, what is the extra value add. So now completely in the open about how low resource settings would have led to better dissemination of technology, which for us in the environment space could actually lead to affordable healthcare in the remotest parts, leading to a better and more affordable for the poor. So your views on this whole low resource certain technology, and while your electricity went off, It's a this one of what happens in the rural areas regularly. So, Dr. Prabhakaran, he's frozen.
Yeah, I think he's having some internet trouble, Harish. I'll just call him up.
Okay, sure.
I've joined back on the phone. So, I didn't hear your question because
my question was, sir. My question was, sir, in the low resource setting, which has now proven that if we had a lot of the technologies, if we had designed from a low resource setting, would have been useful. I was just telling that I had met a vice president of GE a couple of years ago who was the head of medical equipments, and I was surprised to hear from him that efficiency was not a priority. And look at what and it was more about value add to every technology, in, especially in the health sector. So isn't it time for us to relook at technology and look at innovations from a low resource perspective that will help the poor, not only the poor, will help the whole world in many ways? So your views on it.
Right. I think we should rephrase the word low resource setting to unevenly distributed settings and inefficient settings. I think we need to correct these two. And clearly, there are various ways of doing this. There is a huge concentration of unnecessary technologies and unnecessary high-tech investigations.
I think we've lost Dr. Prabhakar.
Yeah, I'll check with you, Harish, if you have any questions.
Allied health profession. Health.
Dr. Prabhakar, your internet.
Hello, can you hear?
Not. It's on and off, sir. It's the this.
Hello.
Yes, sir. Can you continue?
Okay, maybe you can come back to me later on.
Sure, sir. I'll come back to you after I speak to Dr. Alexander, sir. Dr. Alexander, a little bit of a takeoff on the same previous question from the view that if we rephrase the word as Dr. Prabhakaran said, away from the low resource but high efficient, is that something that the private sector would actually look at? Because it's always fun pushing these equipments to selling it to the large hospitals, and you see the large difference between, so related to that is what's happening in the US versus Europe. So how do we push for it? Because that's the way you decentralize healthcare. You create better systems for the poor and have a healthy society that we don't go through this crisis.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Harish. I think a very important question, and I think in the present environment, before COVID came, I think the private sector was being pushed towards in that direction because of various reasons, the insurers, competition. So I think we need to go back. This crisis has taught us we need to go back to clinical assessment instead of depending on more on diagnostics, number one. Having said that, I think one of the advantages of the private sector is, if you look at the last few years, they have been able, at least in the tertiary sector, they have been able to bring in latest advances. So I think it has to be balanced. I think wherever it is required, they need to focus on high-end technology. But at the primary and secondary level, I think we should go more on clinical diagnosis, less on high-cost diagnostics, because I think at the end of the day, healthcare has to be made affordable.
Thanks, Dr. Alexander, for that. Sorry, I was on mute. Can I bring in this time, Mr. Nandkumar, Dr. Nandkumar, who is on the front lines? Sir, you've been two questions. It's related to the last two questions to Dr. Prabhakaran and Dr. Alexander. Related to that, you've been pushing for efficiency so that hospital like yours would greatly benefit from that. But adding to that, what is at the front lines, sir?
I would think for talking about diagnostics, it's important to have as many diagnostic facilities as secondary care, because what separates tertiary from secondary to a large extent is their diagnostic facility. So the need of the hour is to have inexpensive diagnostic facilities which can enable or empower the secondary and primary hospitals to take care of their patients efficiently, because you have a diagnosis. So with a diagnosis, you can have appropriate treatment instead of a shotgun kind of approach. So I would say that that's of paramount importance in a country like ours. And we also have a massive pool of highly trained scientists. So if any country is capable of doing this, we are. And I think inexpensive ultrasound machines, x-rays, CT scanners are critical. I'm not saying that every hospital needs to have it. To give you a small example, in Gudalur, which is the remotest part of Tamil Nadu, the government hospital has acquired a has got a CT scanner. It has made a massive change in the way we've been taking care of our patients, both as far as head injuries are concerned, as well as diagnostic problems in the abdomen and the chest. Now, that one CT scanner has, for this area, has made a tremendous difference. So it's very important for the taluk hospitals to have these facilities to provide good and accurate care so that the proper treatment, results in efficient care, which cuts down expenses tremendously. Hospitalization becomes very, very matter of fact, and the patient is discharged much earlier. So I would push strongly for what Tahandi was talking about with low cost equipment, but I would not say that we do not need these. I would say strongly that we do need these in secondary care hospitals, because the treatment rate is dependent on diagnostics. Our old fashioned clinical methods are important. They are at the point of the first point of contact with the clinical exam, and that gives us an idea of to what we need to order to get an accurate diagnosis. To talk about COVID, we're very fortunate that Nilgiri district has not had too many cases. I see on record right now as 9 positive cases, but we know that that this can become a wildfire kind of a situation. We hope not, but we are quite prepared for it. At our level, we have we are part of the government response team, so we have separated out 15 patients for our COVID as our COVID ward. There are a few things that we have as a group. We have a very close relationship with our tribal community of 20,000, with between health, education, community activities, legal, and so on. And the ground reality is that the first most important thing that we need to look at is the way in which we can isolate people in the villages. Now, the way that our villages work, social distancing is not possible. We are talking more in terms of village distancing. So we are trying our best not to allow people into the village and out of the village, because even health personnel can be transporting COVID into the village, for example, from busy primary health centers and so on. The second is that at the hospital level, we need to have structures in place which could help us quarantine patients. One of the problems that we have been thinking about is if a patient comes in and we are not quite sure if he's positive or not, then we need to keep him quarantined. And we have to have a separate facility for quarantining. We cannot have him in the COVID ward, which already has positive patients. So one needs to isolate him in a room which has a toilet as well as a wash facilities for 14 days. This is a challenge, I think, which SELCO can take up as to how we can go about creating these structures in peripheral hospitals like ours, have four units maybe of this kind of a situation. So a patient comes in who needs to be observed for 2 weeks, and you keep them in this kind of a scenario. And if he worsens, then send him to the government institution. If he has a clear-cut case of COVID, then we can refer him directly. But there are cases where people come back from distant areas after work, the migrant laborers, and they need to be quarantined. We're talking about home quarantine, but in some situations that can be difficult. So one of the things that we would like SELCO to look at is these kind of standalone facilities, maybe have some kind of structure where a few of these rooms can be constructed, it can be small rooms, but which can isolate the patient, and food can be given to him. He can be on his own as far as a toilet and wash facility.
Thank you, Doctor.
The second thing that
we
were looking at is that the patients come in to be triaged. Take too much of your time.
No, continue, Doctor. Continue, Doctor.
Yeah, just one more point. At the triaging level, what we require is that patients be seen as far as possible outside the hospital building. This enables us to look at the patients who do not have COVID. That's a huge group of patients, as was pointed out by one of the speakers, a huge group of patients who do come in with other reasons and other emergencies. So they need to be seen and not mixed up with the COVID people. So a person who has a COVID infection, a cough with high fever, needs to be seen in a place where outside the hospital, because once he comes into the hospital, that room needs to be cleaned. So that's a huge process. So we were wondering if there could be some kind of a temporary structure made in front of the hospital where the person is triaged by the nurse or the doctor, who asks the pertinent questions. If it is possible COVID, he goes into one algorithm, and the other he goes into the hospital. So that's very important. So this kind of an area where they have a roof and maybe four pillars and some kind of protection, and maybe the doctor or nurse stands 6 feet away and does this the questioning, the triaging of the patient. Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Nakta. To people in the audience, Dr. Nandakumar has been working on this from 1990 onwards and to more than 300 tribal hamlets in the Guntur district. And amazing, I mean, fantastic work. Sir, and I come back to Dr. Prabhakar, just to relate it to that, the same question. And if I can add a question from one of the participants, that could technology and e-learning might be a solution at all. I mean, a lot of people have been saying e-learning, e-telemedicine, et cetera, et cetera. Are these some of the immediate steps to address this issue related to the last question, Dr. Prabhakar?
Yeah, I didn't hear many of the previous questions, but I'll just answer this question that you have posed now, whether e-learning, telehealth, and e-technologies are going to be the solution. I would think so, because at least for the near future, meetings like this normally would have happened. We would have gone to a place, there would be 200, 300 people who would be sitting together and hearing what the experts or the participants say. But I think this is the where the future is. But I think we'll have to be a little careful about a few things. Number one is the regulatory framework. What is the regulatory framework? Are we protecting the doctors from litigants if something goes wrong? So that's one area of concern. The second area is it should not be misused, and there is potential for misuse. The third area is privacy. How do we cater to the privacy of the patients who come into this telemedicine programs? In terms of learning, e-learning, as far as the large MOOCs are seen, you know, there are these MOOCs which are run by big universities and international agencies. There's a very limited uptake of this because the concentration waivers, like as we saw now, we have this electricity which goes on and off and people just get disinterested by this, and therefore completion is poor. But I think it will pick up if we package it correctly, if we do it correctly, we make it more interesting, more interactive, with more visuals and things like that. So that is the second thing. The third is, I think the time has come to do away with these medical conferences and have these e-conferences like what we had for the American College of Cardiology recently. And I think there's a huge amount of savings that can happen, which can be channel to better areas. So I think these are my three responses to your question.
Thanks so much, Dr. Prabhakaran. I have a last question both to Dr. Srinath and to Dr. Alexander. And before that, there have been more than 35, 36 questions from the audience. I would request the audience, we would answer each if we could summarize it. If you could send an email to my colleagues, will send out, it's COVID-19@selcofoundation.org. We will send it out to all the people who have come here to speak, not only in this session, but in the corresponding session, and make sure that your questions are answered. So please, I mean, we would copy, but if we could also send this to COVID@COVID-19@SELCOFoundation.org. I hope I'm getting that email right to my colleagues, Rachita, Roshan. So my final question is a little away from what we spoke, because we just have a minute. Sir, it's a desperate question from one of our participants. How many years will it take for us or the world to recover? Because it's a situation we hear ever changing. It's a virus which will have its the social distancing should continue, but it's not going to die down until we get a vaccine. According to you, when do we actually recover?
Well,
Srinath, sir, and then Dr. Alexander.
Well, at the moment, it will be speculative, but it would appear that within a year, we will be able to get a fair amount of immunity. The virus may mutate to a milder form. It can certainly mutate to a wilder form, but likelihood of mutating to a milder form is there. But the vaccine will take at least about a year to 18 months. But till that time, some degree of herd protection can also be achieved. So we'll have to hope that multiple conditions will favor an earlier recovery to an open society. But nevertheless, there would be some degree of social distancing, and there would have to be a fair amount of control on the kind of elements that are given rise to the virus spread in the first place.
Dr. Alexander.
I think Srinath is the expert on this. All I want to say is that I think humanity has been brought to its knees, and that's been for a reason. And I think we need to respect Mother Nature. And I hope that we as a global community will learn from this lesson and we need to continue some of the good practices that are happening now, and we hope that will continue.
Thank you so much, Dr. Srinath, Dr. Alexander, Dr. Prabhakaran, and Dr. Nandkumar, too, for this fascinating start to this webinar. And hopefully, we all learn and especially keep in mind that it's an important lesson that we don't forget just because a crisis goes over. It's many years to, when we say we are talking of can we recover, we also have to keep in mind that for the poor, it's many, many years to recover. So it's not a year. We all have the luxury. We all have the luxury to stay at home, order everything else and say, yeah, I'm having this issue and that issue, but it's a permanent issue to 2.7 to 3 billion people in the world, and we owe it to them. We owe it as a country, India, owe it to the 2.7 billion people in the world, and we can actually show a pathway from resilience, technology innovations, and a more humane approach to healthcare using climate change, using poverty as something to look at. So thank you so much for all of you for coming here, sir. And it's a pleasure and an honor to have all of you and from the front lines.
Thank you.
Over to you, Rachita.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much, Harish. And thank you, Dr. Srinath, Dr. Prabhakaran, Dr. Alex, and Dr. Nandkumar, so much for your views on this topic and setting the context for the next 2 hours as well. I'd also like to, before we move on, just extend our welcome to Father Sunny, who is part of Bhaktil, who runs a lot of health centers and districts in Meghalaya in a PPP model. He's here with a lot of his BHC staff members as well. And in addition to that, we have Prabir Chatterjee sir as well, who has been a long mentor of SELCO, was part of the State Health Resource Center in Chhattisgarh, and again been a guiding light to us in many of our projects from the very beginning. So welcome to both of you. So we start with our next session now, which as we heard, you know, it was a great session, the first session, which was talking more about the situation in the country from a larger context, you know, what are some of the larger learnings that we need to take forward today, but also how it should reshape our thinking about public health in the future as well. And the next session, we'll be hearing from some of the practitioners who've been really at the front line, you know, dealing with the COVID-19 response in their particular geographies, in their own way, in their capacities. And we're really looking forward to learning from them on what are some of the insights that is coming from their side. So in this panel, we have Dr. Ravikant Singh from Doctors for You. We have Dr. Sudarshan from Karuna Trust, Mr. Dinesh from Wish Foundation, and Reverend Dr. Matthew Abraham from Chai, and our colleague from SELCO, Ms. Huda Jaffer as well. So I'll start with you, Dr. Ravikant. I hope you are online.
Yes, I'm online.
Perfect. So just to give our listeners a bit of a background of DFI and you as well. So Dr. Ravikant Singh is the founder for Doctors for You, as I already mentioned. And it is a very unique organization. They call it a medical humanitarian organization. And specifically, their experience has always been very insightful for us because they are always the first to go out there, especially when a disaster strikes. And how do we look at the health infrastructure gap at that point of time? So Dr. Ravikant, who's the founder, as I already mentioned, was also the first Indian to win the SAARC Youth Award for Disaster Relief Work in 2010. And he has a very young and dynamic team of over 300 professionals and from diverse medical, public health, disaster management, and social science background. So, sir, you specifically, I know, have been really in the thick of things. You know, the Bihar hospital near Patna in the Patna district is really preparing for COVID response right now and, you know, trying to see how best, as some of our other panelists also pointed out, that the system, the health system is overwhelmed already with the COVID response, but it doesn't mean that it doesn't cater to the other health needs that are also coming up. So how are you balancing the two? If you could just share with us some key insights, some key learnings that you've had in the past, I'm sure, very long few, 1 week.
Correct. So thank you, Huda, and thank you, SELCO, Harish sir, for organizing this webinar and inviting me for the, as a speaker. So I think personally that what is till now, Corona is roaming around all Western countries, and the exact the amount of damage it will cause is going to determine by what it'll do in Indian and African subcontinent. So I still think that we have just seen around 20-30% of the corona. Much more is going to come, and as Huda said that we are preparing our response as a medical doctor, everybody expects us to respond. So we are making one isolation center, 50-bed isolation center in Patna rural, and 150 bed in Sivaji Nagar slum area of Mumbai. So as you know, we work in disaster mainly. And in disaster management, there are two golden rules. I will discuss on that line only. So the first rule is be prepared for worst case scenario. In any disaster, be prepared for worst. Don't think that okay, this will go down and then we can manage. It's not like that. And exactly this happened in this corona time. We were not prepared and we are not able to think that this can be this big disaster. So the first thing, we took it very lightly, especially the media. So anything happened in China or Pakistan, we first started mockery, jokes bante hain, memes bante hain. So similarly, they so the way the initial like 6 to 8 week when people were dying in China, our media, all reputed news channel, the way they have reported that, even politician and general public, they took it, no, ye to China mein hoga, nothing will happen to India. And only around the time of Holi, around 10th March, we were like little when the government announced that there should be no celebration of Holi. Then we got into mood ki, oh, now things are getting serious. But still, we have our like tendency that unless until something happened to my neighbor, I'm not going to prepare myself. And as Harish Hande sir saying that for us all middle class, we have assets. I'm coming every day, and nothing much has changed for me. And in fact, doctors like me, they are enjoying all kind of thing except all those who are on duty. So the problem, the biggest burden is going to be for our rural population and rural district. So here comes the second thing. The second golden rule is best time to work in disaster is between two disaster. And so we have lost almost initial 2 months, and we have not prepared. And even right now, the most urgent need is to increase the surge capacity of all the rural district who are reporting more than 15 cases. And in these right now, what is happening, we are doing this substitution strategy that all those who are we are canceling elective surgery, we are discharging all the stable patient and then creating bed. But this is not going to solve our problem, because if you in India, you see almost 80,000 pregnant mothers are delivering every day. And so who will going to manage the PPH and all neonatal mortality? Then similarly, that we have lots of diabetic capital of the world, diabetes, hypertension, cardiac disease. If we don't provide them the routine like medication and follow up, they are anyway, we know that they are more susceptible to corona. So we have to think about these also. And for the rural area, we need rapidly deployable hospital beds with toilet. At least all the districts should have one big hospital, at least 200 bed plus or more, and places like Mumbai or other metropolitan cities, even much more. Maybe the way the China has built a 1,000 bed hospital, we have to do that in many other metropolitan cities. Then states like Bihar is in pathetic situation. We just have 0.1 bed per 1,000, so almost one bed for 10,000 population. So I don't know how the Bihar government is going to create these additional bed, and with this lockdown, mobilizing resources is also very difficult. And then the last thing is, we should be prepared for worst case scenario, especially for in rural. If I think that this is going to be like crisis like Ebola in African country, then we can't just depend on the hospital, district hospital or newly built hospital, because number of cases will be too high, and 80% cases are asymptomatic or mild cases which can be managed at home. Fortunately, WHO has already released one home-based isolation guideline. So I think all those districts who are reporting higher cases should start thinking on that way and preparing providing home-based isolation services for the corona positive cases. Similarly, we are going to face a huge shortage of doctors, already facing, and till today more than 50 doctors are already infected, and I don't know the status of nurses. So we can't depend on doctor. We have to train our nurses to handle those mild cases at the community level. Worst case scenario, home-based care. Maybe they can go daily or every alternate day and see the patient. Those household who can have one separate room with toilet and good ventilation, and they can keep them. The third thing is intensive training of our doctors and nurses. As you know, infection prevention hand wash is in very bad condition, even among the doctors and nurses. So they don't think, they still consider corona as like a, if you see that the pictures of Indian doctor wearing this PPE, most of these PPE are basically that HIV kit, which usually we have at PHC or district hospital. But that is not going to prevent us from corona. We need much higher level and higher level of, I'd say, intelligence and alertness from the doctors and nurses in poorer and these rural districts. Otherwise, they are going to infect them in large number, and especially in this initial 1 or 2 months. The fourth is, we have to improve the diagnostic center and the quality of that thing. The fifth is safety and security of our health worker. PPE is still not that much available, and government is claiming that we have the PPE supply, but they might have for the government hospital doctor. But what about the private charitable hospital? I'm getting call from Shaheed Hospital and many other hospital working in Chhattisgarh or remote place. They don't have the access to this. So in fact, we have hired one truck who is going from Delhi to all these states and delivering PPEs to such centers. So government should provide free of cost PPE to all the hospital working on COVID right now, not just government hospital. Then the sixth point is burnout. This is going to be big fight. I don't think that ye 14 tarikh ya agle ek do week mein everything will be settled down. Best case scenario mein next 6 months we have to fight it. Worst case mein it can go more than 1 year. So one of our speaker earlier talked about the burnout. Burnout of doctor is very common, and especially we saw in disaster situation, 3 weeks is the maximum limit. After 3 weeks, even the doctor who is very determined, they also start losing their motivation and stamina. So we need to prepare our second, third, fourth, fifth layer to fight this thing. Then the dead body management. The people who are going to die if their body is going to be very infective, just like cholera or Ebola patient. So we need to train our health worker, our community also, how to handle these dead body. And ideally, it should not be handed over to the community, and community should be aware about all these things. Otherwise, it will create another wave of infection. The eighth point is food security. As Harish said, that the poorest are going to the, I mean, we are doing community program right now in Muzaffarpur district, one of the aspirational districts in Bihar, and we are saying ki corona mein ye mat karo, haath dho, ye karo, wo karo, but they are asking ki khana kahan hai, somebody should come and distribute food. Modi ji bole ki paisa aega, but we have not received it. So we are we are totally clueless how to handle these things. So from yesterday we have started distributing soap and mask, cloth mask, so that at least they should listen to us. So more than 80-90 million ton food stock is still with FCI. So my request to the government and all those who can help in this situation, that the food distribution should be optimal, and thoda jyada bhi dete hain to chalega, but it should not come. Otherwise, what will happen? The state like Bihar, Jharkhand, MP with high load of malnourished children. These children are going to be further malnourished, and they required indoor and critical care. They will going to face this pneumonia, diarrhea, and other cases. Plus, outbreak of measles is also very imminent. So what happened during Ebola crisis in Africa, that they everybody was focused on just on Ebola. So routine immunization band ho gaya, baki routine. So later on, there are many research articles which said that more people or more children died because of infection, vaccine related preventable diseases than Ebola. So that is also my concern. And the another last point is disaster. This is April. In fact, day before yesterday, there was big cyclone in Wayanad district of Kerala and Assam also. So after 2 months, lots of flooding and that all sorts of storm will start. So that will going to further complicate our response. But as I said, don't afraid. I'm just highlighted few things which I should need to be shared there. But I expect there are many good part also of this corona. First thing is this has given big shock, even like from Trump to a tea vendor in our street about the climate change and thing. The second is, public health will get due regard after this control of COVID, and we need to rethink about the climate change strategy and this over explosion of Homo sapiens. So thank you so much.
Now, thank you Dr. Ravikant, for giving us such a holistic picture as well on how are the different ways that the that this pandemic is going to affect the rural areas as well as overall health. But when I come back, would be good to also understand, there are some questions coming in the chat as well on what are some of the permissions, the approvals, like how is it exactly that you're working with the government? I know you have a very good relationship with the Bihar government as well, and there are loads of programs that are being announced. So how are you working with the government right now to strengthen some of the, because there is a role of an NGO to support the government programs as well at the field level. So it would be great to hear from you on that when we come back. But next, I'd like to move on to Dr. Sudarshan from Karuna Trust, and just a bit of a background of Dr. Sudarshan before we look at the specific question itself. So Dr. Sudarshan has actually been a very long-term advisor and partner for SELCO as well. One of the first few partners we reached out to when we started working on health. And he is generally not just a doctor, but a brilliant tribal rights activist, a philanthropist, and very well known for his contributions to the upliftment of the forest-dwelling tribes in the Chamrajnagar district of Karnataka specifically. But while he started there, the organization Karuna Trust in 1986, which was mostly focusing on strengthening primary healthcare through public-private partnerships. Since then, they've also been working in six other states in addition to Karnataka, running over 68 primary health centers, addressing gaps in the poor, low resource settings, as we were talking about in the previous setting as well. So, Dr. Sudarshan, if you could please throw some light on how is the situation in the low resource setting areas where you are working? How are the PHCs and the health workers bracing for the current and the future COVID response? What are some of the learnings that are coming in from your side? And there are a lot of partners here which, like you, are running health centers in, again, low-resource settings. And are there some insights that you would like to share with them at this point of time?
Yeah, I would like to focus. I think there has been too much focus on hospitals and managing the COVID patients. But most important is the comprehensive primary health care. And fortunately, we have in India very robust comprehensive primary health care with the health and wellness centers also coming in. So the role of village health and sanitation and nutrition committee, the ASHAs, the first frontline worker, and then the ANMs and the nurses, and the primary health center itself is very, very important. So I would like to see, we are now working in 71 primary health centers all over India, covering 1.5 million people. And I'm happy to say all our workers, there are no absentees, no people, nobody has applied for leave. All of them are in the field working for the primary health care and taking up the challenge in a very serious way. And I'm 70, I'm not supposed to go to the field, but I myself went to encourage our workers. And I found very, very enthusiastic frontline workers ready to sacrifice everything and work for the community. Now, why I'm saying that there is too much focus on the in the media everywhere about hospitalization, about ventilators and all of that. We are still in the phase where the community spread has to happen. And that's where the primary healthcare can do tremendous job. So we are happy that we have done a lot of work in developing technology for the health workers. We had NCD kits. So all of them have come in handy for us now. Now, the ASHA worker will go to each inner village. She will go and do what is called screening and also surveillance. Screening is, she has a questionnaire. She can either go to the family. If they have a phone number, she can also inquire about their, any problems, the symptoms they have, and then refer it to the doctor or the nurse at the sub-center or the, at the primary health center, and they will advise the treatment and she'll provide it. So when she goes to the family, if there is no telephone, she goes to the family, stands at a safe distance and puts the questionnaire and then makes the diagnosis. That's about screening for the flu symptoms. Second one is a surveillance. She also finds out any new member has come into the village, and where has he come from? Has he come from the infected area? All that she will take and send the details to the primary health center. So the, both the screening and the surveillance is being done every moment in all this population by our ASHA workers. The second level is the fever clinics in our primary health centers. Now, thanks to Cerner, we have electronic medical records in all our primary health centers. So first questionnaire is put to the patient, and if it is a separate queue for flu patients and the, another queue for the ordinary other patients. So the flu patients are first, they come and the doctor sits, makes the patient sit at a distance, further ask some questions, and then the EMR will show low risk or moderate risk or high risk. So the high risk are immediately sent to the hospital. The other two, we have made very systematic screening. If he suspects any pneumonia type of complication, you'll use the gloves, of course, the mask. Asha also uses the mask. There has been shortage of masks, but we have been able to get some cloths stitched, masks also to stand by. So masks have not been a very important problem, but we have been able to provide all of them with the masks. Now, the doctor will wear the gloves and then examine. We have said only three examinations: percussion for a dull note and auscultation for consolidation or crepitations. And third one is the level of oxygen. We also put them on a pulse oximeter and find out the level of oxygen. So these are the three tests done, and then the EMR itself will give the final diagnosis, and then whether it can be managed within the PHC by the medical officer with a antipyretic fever, and then an antibiotic if necessary, and antihistamine. If they are complicated, then they are referred. So this is happening in all our PHCs. And the two important equipment, one is a mask, which we have solved to a great extent. The second one is the sanitizers. We have sanitizers is not a rocket science. I told we get the rectified spirit very easily, surgical spirit as they call it. And you can make your own sanitizer at a much cheaper rate. So we are trying to do that also. The third one is, of course, the infrared thermometer. We are not prepared, and unfortunately, it is a shortage. Maybe in our kit next time, we will add that also, but this time we are trying to procure some infrared thermometers as soon as possible. But that's one equipment which needs to be further demystified and made it available to all the health workers to have them. So with this approach, I feel we have been able to contain, I'm happy to say, except in the urban primary centers in Bangalore, where we had two positives, and one of our health workers, the medical officer herself went and got admitted in the chest hospital and is in isolation ward. But rest of the cases, fortunately, the quarantine mechanism also, they are participating and doing very well. And there is very good cooperation from the community. Even village health and sanitation committees are taking responsibilities, taking care of the people who do not have food, and other people who are homeless. They are also taking care in the primary health care center. So all this is happening. I would say there is also a wonderful convergence happening between the other government departments. Of course, health, we are part of the health department, so we have no problem at all. Of course, the health department has not been responsive to provide the basic things like hydroxychloroquine is yet to be supplied, but we procured hydroxychloroquine as a prophylactic. I want to protect our health workers. So hydroxychloroquine has been obtained, and we are, whoever is at the risk of exposing themselves to corona positive cases, we are giving them the prophylactic treatment. And the masks also have not come from the Drugs and Logistics Society in Karnataka. Other states also have not been able to supply in other states also, but we have been able to procure. And our management team in Bangalore, which oversees the entire operations in the country, they're all active. Our Joint Secretary Venkat is running around all the time, taking a lot of risk. He himself drives the ambulance to meet the health workers and encourage them. And we are many committed such board members in the Karuna Trust who are going around. So the thing is, I myself am surprised at the response which our Karuna Trust doctors, we are about 130 doctors, about 1,000 nurses and ANMs, pharmacists and laboratory technicians, and also about 3,000 ASHAs. All of them are up and doing it. We had some problem of the management team level trying to shirk the responsibility, but they also work on that, and they're all taking responsibility and inspiring the frontline workers to go ahead and do it. So on the whole, I think the gaps and solutions, the gaps which we have is not a serious one. Once we have a commitment and we want to take care of the of people, we can definitely do a good job. So we need to do further innovations. Energy solutions which we have made in the in the primary health centers and sub centers are coming in handy for us. The technological innovations which we had made, they are also very useful. We had the Zoom for our telehealth and tele-education programs, which we are using extensively now to get in touch with all our teams all over India. Thanks to Eco India for providing that Zoom facility for us. And we are also, with the SELCO team, we have evolved several, including the kits which we have provided, have been very useful in combating COVID in the primary healthcare setup. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sudarshan, for that overall summary of how you've been looking at it from a primary health center, a very important aspect of our last mile health delivery, but would be also great to understand, sir, when we come back on what are some of the initial setup that helped you roll it out quickly and support your health staff, the A&M specifically, and I'm sure there are differences in how you would have done that in
answer that. Yeah.
In a state like Karnataka versus Arunachal Pradesh, where the challenges will be slightly different. So it would be great to know on how you went about providing the right information quickly to the staff members of the primary health centers as well. And then how did you look at building their capacity and ramping up the infrastructure support as well for them? So more on that maybe when we come back. But just wanted to go to next to Reverend Dr. Matthew Abraham from Catholic Health Association of India. A little bit about Dr. Matthew. So he has completed medical training in 1993 from Kottayam Medical College, Kerala, with post-graduation at the Christian Medical College, Vellore. And he's currently serving as the Director General of CHAI since about 2016, mid-2016. More importantly about CHAI, they have about 3,000 members across the country, where 500 of them are hospitals, but most of them are smaller clinics and smaller health centers looking at primary and tertiary needs. In again, resource poor areas or low resource areas where, and the CHAI has been supporting them in building up their capacity, either from the screening side, looking at converting and creating new therapeutic units, isolation units, to actually helping provide the right support to the hospitals as well in how to prepare for isolation as well as therapeutic units. So Reverend Dr. Matthew, if you are here and if we can please have you just summarize a bit on how CHAI has been looking at COVID response currently with all its members.
Yeah, good evening. And first of all, thank you for inviting me to be part of this webinar. I stand here with great respect for all those who are giving leadership or all those who are at the forefront fighting this pandemic, because it's very difficult to give leadership during this testing times and also to be in the forefront. So I admire all of those who are in leadership as well as in the forefront. Well, it is part of the Christian ethics or core values that we reach out, or love of neighbor, or we reach out to people. And three concrete ways the church is trying to do that is, one is through education, another one is through social work, and the third one is through healthcare. And being a system, we have these institutions and a system to handle that. Our strength is the numbers, the grassroots presence, as well as the range. I fully agree with Dr. Sudarshan. Prevention is better than cure, and primary healthcare has a great impact. So our network ranges from 80% of them are small health centers, and maybe 15% of them are secondary centers, and 5% tertiary centers. So that's a network. And when it came to healthcare, I'm representing not only the Catholic Church network, the Catholic healthcare network, I'm also representing the Christian network. We have something called the Christian Coalition for Health, which involves not only the Catholic network, but also the Protestant and the Evangelical networks. Put together, we are about 1,000 institutions, as well as maybe about 60,000 hospital beds, ranging from primary care to, you know, tertiary care. Right now, I am the president of that organization, Christian Coalition. So what we have done first is we wrote a support letter to the Prime Minister, expressing our solidarity and as well as our willingness to collaborate. Following that support letter, we were invited for a conference call with the Prime Minister along with some other religious leaders. So as a follow-up, we are working with the Ministry of Health and trying to figure out how we roll this out. There are three major concerns we brought it up to the Prime Minister as well as to we are working on with the Ministry of Health. One is, how do we protect the caregivers? If you don't protect the caregivers, we will not be able to sustain this fight. If the caregivers fall sick or if something, you know, drastic happens to them, we have to quarantine them, we have to treat them, and the motivation of the caregivers will be affected, and we will not be able to sustain this. That was our primary concern. The second concern we raised was, Dr. Alex mentioned about it, that the, the patient load has come down, procedures are cancelled, so hospitals are struggling to pay even salary. So how do we also generate some financial support? The third concern was, even though we can work at the national and national levels, being a national organization, the action really happens at the district level, and also health is a state subject. So we raised the concern of, how do we bring more coordination at that level? How do we leverage the public sector as well as the private sector by having a better coordination, especially at the district level where, you know, all these activities happen? So this is what we have been trying. We have formed a committee to follow up with the Ministry of Health. There are some directives that has come from the Ministry of Health, which is very helpful. One is about not to mix up COVID patients as well as the general patients. There are clear guidelines. And also, how do we not to take up patients without protective equipment. So all these are very helpful, and patients as well as caregivers are also covered under insurance schemes. Dr. Alex mentioned about those things. I wouldn't say it is only because of the Christian Coalition for Health. Several organizations are intervening, but these are all very good directives that has come from the government. As a network, healthcare network, what we are trying now is, we all know that the cases are not very great compared to other countries here. So we are still not in a very, very difficult situation. And most of the cases are being managed by the government centers or dedicated COVID centers, which the government has declared. So if the situation worsens, there will be a heavy load on the healthcare system. Therefore, we are preparing our member institutions, the hospitals and the health centers or whoever in the network, to be ready and to follow these guidelines and to make sure that we can sustain this fight by protecting the caregivers. So protective equipments, you know, all those things are a concern. So one is the preparedness. We are doing a lot of online webinars. We are also having a learning platform, which we are using. There are curated courses on this. We don't have to prepare any new courses because there are a lot of courses developed by WHO and also. We have curated and we are using our learning platform to help our sisters as well as our healthcare providers, to also those who manage the institutions, to learn. So that is one thing which we are doing. We are also trying to figure out how to get protective equipments. One of the ways we are trying is, since the government has a lot of, starting with the government institution, we are also trying to work with government to provide equipments, and also trying to raise some resources for this. The third area which we are working is regarding the socioeconomic impact of migrants and the daily laborers who lost their work and those who are going hungry. As I mentioned in the beginning, church also has, we also have a huge network of social work organizations We also have a network of schools as well as healthcare institutions. So through these institutions and the networks, we're trying to see how we can also, we have prepared food packets which will, there are certain contents in that. So it will sustain a family for about 15 days. So it costs about 1,000 rupees. So we are also trying to make this available for the people. Another area where which we have been very much active is the preventive measures. Even before the lockdown was announced, the church leaders, especially Cardinal Oswald Gracious, the president of the CVCI, Catholic Bishops Conference, he came up with a directive to the churches, the parish priests, saying that there should not be any open liturgies. Okay, Mass is going on, priests are celebrating privately, but there is no gatherings. The maximum people allowed are only 3 or 5, so these private celebrations are going on. So that is that has been given. So we are trying our level best to abide by the. And after Cardinal Gracious came, most of all bishops came up with the same kind of directive. So all the churches are closed down. People are asked to be, to remain at home and pray. This is an important time for the church, the Holy Week and the Easter celebrations. So in spite of that, all these measures have been taken. So overall, this is what we are trying to do, trying to, prevent the spread as much as possible, trying to get involved at the grassroots level, right from primary care to tertiary care, preparing our institutions if there is a overload of patients. We are also trying to work with the government. And we have several online meetings and all those things going on. And it's not easy to give leadership during these difficult days. I think that's what I would like to share for the time being. So I stand in solidarity, in action and prayer with all those who are working against COVID-19. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Father Matthew, for just giving us an insight on how you've been supporting the network. There have been questions around the e-learning modules that you spoke about, and maybe we can come back to that or maybe answer them offline post the webinar as well. I'd like to come to Mr. Dinesh now, who is the state program and technical head at Wish Foundation, specifically looking at their program in Rajasthan. And again, just to, in Rajasthan itself, Wish Foundation has been, I think, working with about 24 primary health centers and the subsequent sub-centers. A lot of last mile work again to identify asymptomatic patients, creation of isolation wards. But another thing, Dinesh, if you could please touch upon, is there has been a lot of mention on telemedicine from the first session to the second session as well. And I know Wish Foundation has been looking at that also. So I'm wondering if you could maybe throw some light on that as well, if that is something that you are leveraging upon in your work in Rajasthan currently. Yes, Dinesh. Dinesh, sir?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much, SELCO, for giving me this opportunity. So I'll just brief you about what is the organization. So WISH is an acronym for Vadwani Initiatives for Sustainable Health. Sunil Vadwani is the entrepreneur who is the founding member of this organization. So the organization vision is is the quality healthcare for all. And our mission is strengthening primary healthcare through innovations. And we are working in 5 states: MP, Rajasthan, Assam, Delhi. So what we are doing in Rajasthan for almost 2015, we are running, when we have entered in Rajasthan, the Rajasthan government wants us to try for primary healthcare. So we have started with them, and now as of now, we are running their rural PHCs as well as their urban PHCs. So I will discuss more on what we are doing in our innovations, telemedicines, and what is the learning in the COVID, how we are managing, how we are supporting with the government. So there are So in our Rajasthan, we found that this is working. So we followed all the comments. Government is like,
Dinesh sir, I think you're on mute.
So it was disconnected somehow.
Oh, please.
So, So we follow all the government orders, because in the COVID, all the orders are coming from the government. And being a PV partner, we are providing all the support to the government. Well, our routine services, apart from maternity and all these services, are going on. Few of the camps, like outreach camps, MCHND or VHND, those are stopped for some time. There are regular OPDs is going on, infections, then line listing are we are preparing. What we follow up for and understand what are being
Sorry, one second. I think the network is a little slow. So could we maybe try by switching off the video? It might improve the bandwidth slightly, because your voice is breaking. Sorry about that, sir.
Okay. Well, that's okay.
Yeah.
So our doctors are also a part of isolation ward. So the government using our doctors to put them on a isolation so that they can provide those services. Apart from that, our paramedics and doctors are also engaged in providing support at a district and state level boundaries. So they are using our people to trace the people who are coming from other districts or other states. So we are providing that also. What we differently done in COVID, that like Dr. Sudarshan has said, that we have tried simple solutions, like we have separated OPDs. So the patient with ILI cases, we have separate OPD for them. So there is a trias from the entry level only. We have tried that how the social distance can be taught to the all the community. So when the, any patients come, we already marked areas where they need to go. So there is always a distance between the patient also. We have shifted our OPD from a small room to a big room, or go in an open area, so that we can our team is less infected, or they can be more secured. We have used telemedicine a lot. So at a health and wellness center, our GNMs, we have additional GNM there who provides telemedicine services. So all the patients is coming to our telemedicine services. We provide those, and we found that we can trace easily, and we can consult the doctors that is it. It's required a referral. Is it required more follow-up? So we are using the telemedicine and routine checkup also at a health and wellness center, at a sub-center level. Apart from that, we have used a telemedicine in providing training to our PSC staff. So we have already started using orientation module, using the telemedicine in providing different modules of training on our COVID, how they want be more safe, or what are the guidance provided by the government of India, government of Rajasthan, what they need to do. We have partners with various organizations on innovations. So we plan, so there are discussion by Dr. Alexander that there must be last mile solutions for the last mile workers. So we have come out with various innovations, and we tried and roll out those innovation in our last mile. So recently, through BIREC support, we come to know about a product called Dozy. This Dozy, we have discussed with few of the district officers, and one of the district officers has said, why don't you provide that? So the Dozy is basically a product which can be put on a bed, below the bed, and it can provide a heart rate and respiratory rate without touching. So it's a non touch devices. So we are trying and see that would it be how we can save our medicos and paramedics, so that we don't infect them, and it's a high risk to them also. So we are trying all the type of provisions. apart from that, there are a huge shortage of PPV, N95, 3 layers masks. We are not getting. So we have tried and find a different ways. We have we provided to all our PHCs the supply of hand sanitizers, hypochloride, and 3 layers masks. Apart from that, the psychological and financial support, how we can provide them. So what we have tried, sir, on a daily basis, our district, but what we are doing that is we are calling all the PHC staff and understand them what challenges they are facing. We motivate them, they are our soldiers. And we want to make them convinced that all the support will be provided by the organization. Apart from that, we do lots of community activities. We use ANM and ASAs on routine community visits. Our ANMs and ASAs are going for a field, doing a household survey. The government has asked to do the surveys for ILI cases, the surveys who are coming from other districts, other states. So we provide all this information to our to the government. Apart from that, there are certain issues we have faced. Before going to the challenges, I just want to add that we have also, in the last mile, what we are facing that there is no dashboard for the availability of PPE kit or the mask and things. So we have developed that for all our PHCs. So we know that how many supplies is available at our level. And similarly, we can fill those gaps related to this dashboard and supply. What we found that frontline are somebody who has come out very eagerly and they are doing extraordinary. Two of our ANMs who is going to maternity leave, but they have cancelled their maternity leave and they are still working the ground. We have asked to take all the precautionary support. Having said that, there are challenges also. What we are finding that everywhere the getting a PPE kit, N95 or 3-layer masks is a huge challenge. In few of the areas like at Tong PHCs, due to this NRC and other issues, the community is not providing solutions or the information. Few of our staff has been harassed by the community, so we have taken the police support and tried to counsel them. It is for them. One of our staff is also home quarantine because we found that ANM is having some other symptoms. So this type of challenges we have started facing. So two of our urban PCs have started positive cases. So all our staff has been very daily they are working to struggle. There are lots of teams has been made by the government. Our team is providing all the support, and the situation for them is very, very dangerous sometimes because the required equipment is not available sometimes. So we are trying that how we can save them. So broadly, this foundation is providing all the required instrument to the last mile so that they are not infected and we can secure their safety. So this is from my end. If any questions, I'm able to answer.
Thank you, Dinesh, sir. And I don't know if we'll have time for a second round, but I know we all know that Rajasthan has an influx of migrants coming in, and how do we look at the proper screening, the awareness, and obviously the role of the frontline workers become extremely important. I understand one of the Mr. Swapnil Tembe, who is the DC of East Karo Hills, has also joined us, and that's one of the problems that he's facing as well. So even if not today, maybe we could have a learning session with you on how you've been looking at that specifically for some of our other partners as well. I'd go to the next speaker now, Ms. Huda Jaffer, who's the director of SELCO Foundation. Huda, are you online? Huda? Yeah. Huda, we can't hear you.
Oh, sorry, yeah. This is good. Can you hear me?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, okay. Hi, thanks so much. Thank you, Rachita. Thanks so much to the speakers for being here. I won't take much time given the time, but I just wanted to quickly talk about a few things that we have been doing with our health partners, with our livelihood partners. One, of course, I think it's been mentioned repeatedly, the lack of resources and equipment for PPEs and masks and things like that. Sort of connect and coordinate people with any kind of emergency needs, connecting them within the network as well as outside of the network. I think beyond that, we've also been doing a lot of capacity building and powering and infrastructure setup for like areas in the borders, police checkpoints, border screening areas, powering these places, looking at, you know, providing infrastructure in these places. But also, I think with some of the health partners, both government health partners as well as the private health partners, working on what we heard in the first session on how do you increase the capacity or of especially of isolation and therapeutic units in response to COVID to be able to tackle it better. And I think as Dr. Srinath said in the beginning that, you know, we can't do a sudden ramp up. So specifically in post-disaster situations like this, how do we set up these kind of units in low resource settings? That's what we have been working on. Just to give you a quick sense of, you know, this is kind of the matrix of right from your quarantine ward, isolation ward, basic therapeutic units, and your kind of proper ICU units that are needed. Just maybe some figures I can point your attention to. It's, you know, 300 beds per 100,000 population that is needed and recommended. Each of our district hospitals cater to about 200,000 population and would not have more than 50 to 80 beds, right? So how do you make sure that we ramp up this capacities within the districts as much as possible? Each of these, I think what we have been able to do is go through the guidelines, national guidelines, global guidelines, as well as expert opinions, and sort of distill out what is needed to be done at a block and district level to set up these locations, to set up these essential kind of units with the toilets, with the showers, with the kind of heaters that would be needed for the healthcare. And there are two mainly ways of doing this. I think one that we've seen is, you know, converting existing infrastructure as isolation units, as therapeutic units. And the two is really renovation, quick upgradation, you know, extension of hospitals. Like a lot of times I think we hear people saying that, you know, there is no IPD, OPD happening because it's been converted into an isolation hospital. So how do you do a quick setup IPD, OPD so that patients can actually continue to get basic care, right? So these are the kinds of things that we have been working on. We will share these guidelines with participants, and please reach out to us, because what we've also done is mapped out specifically the kind of vendors and the manufacturers and deployment experts who can actually move things during this time, and who are able to supply and who are able to construct these quick shift units, you know, both inbuilt with energy, inbuilt with kind of green building designs as well. These are some parameters on the extension, the infrastructure extension or upgradation. There are basically four types that we're looking at right now, right? Either we're looking at retrofitting shipping containers or heavy duty canvas tents. Both of these, I think Ms. Dr. Ravikant also spoke about the summer and the kind of comfort levels that's needed to work in the PPE suits. You know, both of these are highly difficult to work within for health workers, also for patients. The prefabricated structures, I think these are basically the structure ones are the ones that, you know, 10% gets done in a workshop and 90% is done on site. And structure two is where almost 50% gets done in a workshop and 50% gets done on site. So there are pros and cons to both of them. But for this session, maybe what I wanted to sort of direct your attention towards is the kind of time that it takes to actually deploy these units. You know, with this is all including all the sanitation, the soak pits, all of those auxiliary units. You know, it is not something that you can do immediately, right? But just for a 10 bed unit to up to a 100 bed unit, how much time would it take to actually deploy these settings? So we will share these guidelines as well, which basically include entry and exit zone guidelines if you're setting these up, patient accommodation guidelines, as well as the sanitation, waste supply and waste management guidelines for healthcare workers and for people running these institutions as well. So I just wanted to quickly end there because we don't have that much time for the next session, but please reach out to us. I think even the inputs that Dr. Nandakumar has given on, you know, setting up these 6 feet distance screening areas, where patients can be immediately screened. So definitely take inputs on what is needed at this moment to be set up, and we sort of do our best to mobilize what we can for the health partners working in the front line. So I'll stop there, Rachita, so you can get more time for other speakers as well. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Ahuda, since you are moderating the next session, do I have permission to go on with maybe one or two questions for some of the panelists?
Sure.
Okay. Sorry, I muted myself by mistake. Dr. Ravikant, if you're still there, I wanted to just come back to you with the question on how is it that you've been working with the government? What kind of permissions or approvals are required even to convert a hospital when you're looking at isolation units, therapeutic units? Are there certain protocols that you have to follow? How is it that you are able to engage for the supply chain, for all the aspects? Could you give us some thoughts on that quickly? And I would request you to please keep it about 5 minutes if possible. Maybe even less than that if possible, yeah.
So surprisingly, this time, like, the government is very proactive, and they themselves requested many NGO CSO partner to support them. And especially in, like, in we are working in Mumbai and Bihar. So in Mumbai, MCGM has given their building, and both of us, MCGM as well as Doctors for You, jointly we are going to purchase the additional beds, equipment and the consumables which will be required to run the isolation center for a few months. So and of course we have approached them, and we said that we want to support these items, and they are supported. Similarly, in Bihar, we have submitted the profile of our hospital, and we contacted directly a state health society. I think in every state, we have a state health society and district level district health society. And any organization with this kind of health infrastructure, hospital or any building which can be converted into quarantine center or isolation and treatment center, they can approach, and government is very supportive and listening to the all the NGOs, and they are ready to support medicine and support they are ready to give. So I don't see any problem right now. This is about health. Even other sector, like for food distribution, counseling, we need lots of counselors, social worker, because in these quarantine center, people should stay. So they required counseling, otherwise wo ek do teen rehta and then they leave the center. So they need to be counseled. So the requirement of counselor is also very high. So all sort of people can work and support the government in this fight.
Sure. Thank you, Ravikant sir. And if we have any other follow-up questions from the participants, then maybe we'll reach out to you separately later after this as well. Dr. Sudarshan, just to come back on the question I earlier was pointing towards in just the basic infrastructure, you know, if you compare your work in Karnataka versus the work in Odisha, Arunachal Pradesh, the kind of infrastructure that's there, the support that might be there, is there any difference in the way that you engage with the communities there also? Is there any difference in that?
I think it really doesn't matter as long as we have a well prepared, robust primary healthcare setup, comprehensive primary health setup, which we are always had. So we are not facing any new problems, except that reaching out to some of these masks and sanitizers and hydroxychloroquine for the prophylactic tablet, chloroquine. These were some of the challenges, but we have. There is no transportation. Courier is not operating. I got some hydroxychloroquine. I have to send it to Arunachal Pradesh, but it's tough to do it. Post office is trying to do something, but I don't know. So the transport will, hopefully it will improve and then we will be able to reach out. Otherwise, thanks to the telemedicine Zoom, which we are extensively using, we are able to contact each of the PHCs and talk to them and find out their problems and solve them. And a lot of them are very, I'm surprised at the enthusiasm and the courage our health staff have shown so far, and very good. I think the convergence with the government is also wonderful. Things are happening, and a lot of people have come in for food distribution parallelly. Other NGOs are also coordinating with us in providing that. So it's all a good sign. I think things are moving. The remoteness of Northeast has not separated us. Meghalaya still doesn't have a positive case, but still we are up and working on it to preventing the disease to come there. So it's working well, yeah.
Sure. Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Sudarshan. And thank you so much for our panelists. I think we will end the session here. So thank you again, Dr. Sudarshan, Dr. Ravikant, Dr. Dinesh, and Father Matthew. I know it's a very busy time for all of you. So taking out time, speaking to our participants here, sharing your experience, extremely, extremely honored. Just a note to our participants again, I know there are questions that are probably left unanswered, but we will definitely follow up post the webinar as well and respond to each one of you. We will start with our next session quickly. Before that, I'd also like to just welcome, I know we have some representation from the different press and media houses as well. So I think Harish mentioned earlier, our email ID is covid19@selcofoundation.org. And if you need any follow-up questions answered by any of the panelists or any other information, please do reach out to us for anything at all. Huda, my colleague, will be moderating this panel. Huda?
Thank you. Thanks, Rachita. I thank you so much for the previous panel. I welcome the final panel of the day. This is basically voices from the government, specifically state level government, and their responses to looking at combating the COVID response during the lockdown. So I'm going to quickly introduce our panelists for this session. Dr. Rakhal Gaitonde, he comes with immense experience and expertise on public health, but also serves on the National Asha Mentoring Group, which supports the Government of India and is implementing a large community health worker program with the Government of India, also on some of the expert committees for COVID-19. Dr. V. Ravi, I think Dr. Ravi would not be able to join us. He was supposed to join us, but maybe is called away on some urgent matter. We have also with us Dr. Ajit Kumar Sudke. His career spans with more than a decade of immense experience working with the Indian health system and the National Health Mission, including practical applications for reproductive health, maternal health, newborn and child flagship programs that he's worked with the Government of India. I'm very pleased to welcome Shri Sampath Kumar. Sir, thank you so much for being here. Shri Sampath Kumar is presently the Commissioner and Secretary to Health and Family Welfare Department, Government of Meghalaya. We also have with us Mr. Sanjeev Jain, who is currently the Chief Engineer at CREDA, Chhattisgarh Renewable Energy Development, and who's done a lot on strengthening the public health systems as well as the district hospital's capacity to deal with the issues in Chhattisgarh. So to start off this session, so we know that everybody's time is precious, but you're handling an entire state. So Shri Sampath Kumar, we'll start off with you. Quickly to just check in with you on how is the situation right now in Meghalaya and what are the plans that the state has, just some of the phase-wise plans that the state has, along with some of the challenges or gaps that you see moving forward. Thank you, sir.
So good evening to all of you, and good evening, Ms. Huda, so for inviting me for this. I would like to share it with you about Meghalaya. In fact, my colleague is also, I think, he's also participating, Swapnil. He also must be there. So one, I must thank SELCO Foundation and also PHFI, and other partners for putting up this webinar. I was just listening to some of the speakers, in fact, Dr. Sudarshan and other speakers. It's very so first, actually, from the government point of view, I would like to tell you what actually, you know, we have been doing in Meghalaya. I thought I'll give you a very broad picture. What we did, in fact, first of all, you know, we are very fortunate. You know, we got a lead time, you know, when this corona was actually heard in China. We started taking, basically a preventive action much earlier. So we, by 24th January, we put in a system wherein actually those who are actually coming from abroad, especially from these affected countries, they have to register and, you know, they have to go for a quarantine. So we put that system, like, you know, a lot of students who were studying in China, they have come back and, you know, we put that surveillance system. So actually, in fact, then we worked out, you know, when it was actually moving, you know, fast because of its high transmissibility. So we, you know, we, in fact, we've analyzed it. In fact, we have also, you know, had an opportunity to, you know, take the advice of some research institutions like PHFI. You know, we have a Indian Institute of Public Health is there in Shillong. So we have actually started understanding this particular disease. And then we have come out with a three-pronged strategy. So the three-pronged strategy, what we have, we put this in place. And this is essentially the first strategy is actually how actually we can, you know, basically track this entire transmission chain, you know, through through data. So we thought like data driven, tracking of transmission chain. So we put in a system how actually the every individual who is coming from these affected areas, how actually we can track them, and systematically we can actually ensure that, you know, ensure that isolation and isolation. So we put, we've over 13,000 people, returned from these affected places to the state. And we have actually put a system, we have put the entire regulations, invoked this Epidemic Diseases Act, and we put them under home quarantine. We put them a system to actually guide them. We have actually engaged some medical volunteers and citizen support group. So, and also the counselors. So this is the way actually we've, been actually running through a data-driven, tracking of the entire transmission chain. This is the first strategy that we have been actively, looking at it. And, we also have the IVRS calls every day. You know, we have IVRS calls going to all these people and getting a data, like, who's having any symptoms, and, again, tracking them, going for a testing of those cases which have symptoms. So this mechanism was one thing actually found to be very useful for us in terms of bringing a lot of awareness and a lot of, community responsibility. Then the second strategy that what we have actually deployed is that how the health system strengthening, because that's very important. As a government, one of the things which is very important during these times is that how actually you build the confidence of the people. You know, a lot of anxiety, a lot of, people look at, what is happening all over, how actually we are, going to build that confidence by strengthening the health system. So we started from about 100 isolation beds to today we have about, 1200 isolation beds in the state. So so how that's again an activity that we did. In fact, this is again, this disease is a very interesting, virus. It is again a challenging our regular, health practices. We can't actually keep them, keep the infected people in one room together. So we require private wards. In fact, so you require independent bathrooms, independent toilets. So it require, so we have to really create a new infrastructure. So we have come out with this, again, a concept of this Corona care centers. Essentially what we did was we have actually, converted a large infrastructure into Corona care centers. In fact, today we have about 500, bed capacity, the systems that we have built. So this is another thing. Again, coming back to the ventilators, you know, all that, you know, putting in them in place, and the medicines like hydroxychloroquine to azithromycin, like, you know, getting those stocks. So what we did, actually, we have, you know, constituted one medical expert committee. In fact, this is another thing that taught us was that there is so much experience and expertise is there within the state. So we could able to, you know, attract that entire thing, like as I said, from IIPH Shillong to, in fact, even we have also used Indian Statistical Institute for doing a mathematical modeling of predictions. What is the prediction and, you know, what should be the preparedness? So we have come out with the different scenarios and we prepared those, all that based on the prediction. So it was a very interesting exercise, and we could able to, you know, what we did, actually, we have built our entire health systems to, for the worst case scenario now. So that's like a, so that's why now actually we are, after doing that, when then we started actually putting protocols. If you have one case, you know, what should be the protocol? If you have 10 cases, what should be the protocol? If you have 100 cases, what should be the protocol? So this kind of a, you know, rigorous, you know, basically drill that actually we did. So that's one second strategy that I wanted to tell about. The third, actually, the strategy, especially for not only for prevention but also for mitigation, is the community capacity building. So this, actually, we strongly believe in this. In fact, we found this is where in case of because this COVID might not go immediately, because it requires the medical innovations are required to bring appropriate strategies for eradicating this COVID, like the way we did for polio, we did for other diseases. It requires some time. So but we need to build the community capacity how actually they can live with COVID. So you shouldn't actually, we should remove the fear. So fear removal is one of the important strategies of our work, how actually we can build that capacity. So we have so to do that, when what are the things that need to be focused upon? So we have come out with the three non-negotiables, which actually we have been right from the beginning. We started putting that three non-negotiables, how important is social distancing, how important is hand hygiene, how important is following the respiratory etiquette. So we brought out this again and again, and involving the traditional headmen, especially we have six schedule area, we have a traditional institution. So we actively engage the village headmen in terms of how actually they can use this non-negotiables, and how they can actually build the capacity, how they can take up the responsibility even for home quarantine, so they know actually now what is home quarantine, how actually it needs to be religiously in fact practiced for those people with travel history. So that's another area that we have focused upon. In fact, as I said, we also have this particular in fact the COVID situation also has given us an opportunity to really strengthen the lot of health systems. We could now we could able to get the ventilator support that is required for a situation where you have a community transmission, where so that's where we could build that infrastructure across the state. And but as I said, in fact, this is a new very disease. In fact, it requires a new way of thinking. As I said, it's an elitist thing, like in the sense like it requires an independent room. You can't actually have the general wards. So it's a completely one has to understand this one, and maybe we require to really learn to live with it. That's another thing, how actually we can prevent it and also we can actually live safely. So I think that's the way, that's where actually we have been focusing upon. And I just said the data is something is very important to contain this one. The way actually the government of India has come out with this Arogya Setu and this kind of an app, these are the things I think through which actually we can contain this. I think this is about the
Sure. Sir, I can quickly ask you two follow-up questions to that. I think in the previous sessions also, people alluded to the fact that, you know, it is if the basic care is hampered during this corona, you know, response efforts, the IPD, OPD, general care is hampered. One is, are you seeing that and how are you overcoming that issue? And two is, what do you wish? I mean, because you mentioned ventilators, right? You need along with that energy, you need along with that right kind of environment to these, you also need along with that appropriate training, because these are not things that, you know, any unskilled person would be able to work on. So just one is the how are you balancing the general care with the corona thing, and second is, what do you wish hoping that what is the wishes, what would help you deal with this more easily if certain things were already in place?
So, yeah, one, I'll tell you definitely the balancing. It's a very important fact. I keep telling our medical officers and, you know, everyone. In fact, Meghalaya has got highest maternal deaths in terms of like MMR is very high. So almost like 200 mothers die every year because of lack of proper, you know, the institutional delivery system and all that. So it's a so similarly, you know, almost like a similar number die because of TB, and same is the case with the cancer. So in fact, this is a very important thing. That's where we wanted to ease out the pressure, you know, of this COVID on the existing healthcare institutions. What we devised was that majority of the COVID cases can be dealt in the corona care centers now. Because, you know, 85% of the cases, which actually, in fact, we have devised, we've categorized all the patients into four categories. A, you know, asymptomatic positive, you know, B, mild, you know, positive, C, severe symptoms, and D is a critical care unit, you know, critical patient. So A, B can actually, the majority of the 80-85% of the patients who are expected to come, like if at all, if there is any outbreak. So they can be treated in other infrastructure, not in the existing healthcare infrastructure. So that way, that's one thing that we really understood. And we also were, you know, highlighting that's very important. That second, of course, we also have an advantage of a Negrin one institute, national, you know, one of the national institutions there. It's a northeastern, it's like a equivalent to the AIMS. So we have we're also starting a telemedicine also to deal with non-COVID related medical care. But definitely, I think it's again, as I said, like the COVID is actually asking us to do things differently. I think maybe we might require to really look at this telemedicines and the online medication and, you know, different. We might require to invest a lot in the healthcare infrastructure. We might require to invest a lot in, you know, the building the capacity of the communities. In fact, I would like to share one small thing. I'll stop here. So there is a, in fact, way back in 2006-07, there used to be a lot of deaths of malaria in Meghalaya. Meghalaya used to be the number one state in terms of malarial deaths. You know, not less than 100-150 people used to die only because of malaria. So what we did was, we actually, you know, trained ASHAs, NRHM came, the ASHAs, we have trained them how to prick and, you know, how to test, you know, we have given a rapid diagnostic kits. And today, 70% of malarial cases are handled by ASHAs. So that's the kind of a capacity that we need to build. Even for in future, the vision for us is that, like, how actually we can build the capacity of these ASHAs and, you know, AAA, what we call, how actually they can easily deal with home quarantine, how they can easily deal with the care for A and B category patients, even, you know, in the worst case scenario. So that's the kind of a you know, capacity we need to build. In fact, if you ask me, this is one thing that you ask me, like, what if it is there? Yes, definitely. I would say, in fact, we require to invest a lot, and as I said, in the capacity of the people and the communities, as well as even the medical side. You know, we require to build a lot of their capacity in terms of, we require more specialists and more, you know, so active engagement is required. I think if that were to be there, we can handle it effectively. Thank you.
Sure. Thank you so much, sir. I think investing in health infrastructure definitely would be a priority, and hopefully we're able to leverage and double down while that's a priority to make the most of it. I want to go to Dr. Rakhal now. Dr. Rakhal, you've been in multiple discussions with government, with special experts, with in special committees for COVID-19. I have a specific question for you on, every time healthcare is in general pushed from a centralized perspective, what role do you feel government can play in further decentralizing this? With your, experience in Kerala and Tamil Nadu, what role do you think government can play in decentralizing healthcare and strengthening it further?
Okay. So first of all, thanks very much to SELCO for inviting me. And PHFI and the other organizers. So maybe to start off with directly answering your question before sort of getting into some of the issues that I thought I'd flag. I think the one of the things that we all are beginning to, it's finally I think dawning on us, is that COVID is not something that we are going to get rid of in a month or two. And I think the more we see the different, modelings and the projections that, we are being fed with, regardless of, what the assumptions are, one thing that is clear is that we are looking at having to deal with this over the period of 6 months to even a year. Okay. Now, this is to us a very, very sobering fact. Because all these changes, all these sort of knee-jerk reactions, these whole range of infrastructure that we are asking for and putting up and all of that, are we looking at it in periods of 1 year? Are we looking at it what is going to happen for 6 months, to a year? And I think that is a question we need to really focus on. And that is where decentralization, I think, really comes to play a very, very big role. Today, I think one of the strengths of, for example, the Kerala, the Kerala sort of response has been the ability for panchayats to actually take a huge burden of the social protection aspect of the whole approach to actually reach out to families who are in, quarantine. To actually reach out to actually have very granular sort of maps of people who are widows, the number of vulnerable individuals, the number of people who require cooked food, the number of people who require dry rations so that they can cook. Now, these sort of very, very minute decisions, actually panchayats are already empowered to. So governments can, roll out a whole range of things and we know that the panchayats will sort of take care of these sort of things. Similarly, in terms of actually looking at contact tracing, actually looking at the follow-up and the mental health of people in quarantine, for example, again, much of these activities has been handed over to PHCs, have been handed over to panchayats who are actually doing that. So actually that takes a huge burden off the health system to focus then on more immediate tasks of treatment and so on. So I think, but of course, these sort of capacities are not built overnight. And it comes with, I think, decades of investment and developing and strengthening decentralized systems. So I think this is one thing that I think all of us need to take back, from this in a post-COVID world, I think, probably decentralization and strengthening of these capacities would be, something that is really, really key. But I think also what is important, and I'm just, I've been sort of caught the last four or five presentations, is I think that at some point we need to become much more granular in our thinking. And what I mean is that I think till now, I think we are largely driven by, standards that, are across and are universal. Okay. But I think we need to be a little more granular in terms of two things. And this is just, again, reflecting on some of the conversations we are having here in Kerala. This is not necessarily the official Kerala government sort of stand, but this is happening in discussions in various committees. So the first is, I think we need to be clear about the stage in the epidemic different regions are. I think there are some probably regions, you know, for example, probably Bombay with, you know, about 900 cases with a large number of people, you know, requiring care, is clearly very different from probably a, you know, another district in, you know, Maharashtra or probably Meghalaya or other places where they are not reporting any cases. You know, obviously, you know, one could turn into the other, but the objectives of a given administration would be very different in these two settings. And therefore, the infrastructure needs would also be, you know, need to be sort of rationalized based on that. I'm seeing some questions on the chat, you know, thing, for example, saying there are so many, you know, individuals who've come in from, you know, as migrants, for example, just pre or post lockdown in Rajasthan, for example, Odisha, for example, and other places. Now, I think these are, you know, districts where, you know, quarantining would be the topmost activity. And what we really need to build up are, you know, facilities for quarantine, you know, compassionate operations for quarantining, for, you know, for getting the message of what, why, and, you know, why this is important and so on and so forth. And therefore, the objective for, you know, for control activities, the objective for infrastructure would be, for example, preventing imported cases. Whereas in another, you know, district where you have widespread infection, probably your objective will be to, you know, contain an epicenter and to move towards, you know, treatment. I'm not saying we shouldn't be prepared, but I'm just saying we need to be granular. We need to keep looking. We need to be flexible, nimble, if you may, so that, you know, we can prioritize, you know, this sort of thing rather than, you know, just creating huge amounts of infrastructure, you know, which we don't really need know what to do. The second is to also then be granular with regarding to the context. And what I mean by this is that different regions obviously need very, very different capacities. Just to go with, for example, you know, the need for isolation centers. Now, in a situation like Kerala, probably where quite a few people have their own individual houses, as you know, a starting point, you know, baseline where we are, probably the requirement for, you know, new isolation centers to be put up would not be such a priority as probably other places where, you know, this is not necessary there. So I think we need to then, you know, have very different standards. We need to be able to choose from a menu of what each state or each district even requires. Take, for example, this whole question of secondary care. Now, we know, for example, that we have buildings that are not fully utilized. Taluk hospital probably can do with a few more beds and, you know, all of that sprucing up can be done very quickly. But do we have oxygen? Now, that to me is a huge, you know, sort of bottleneck, because even if you have a good setup, but you don't have adequate oxygen, that is not going to be adequate for a secondary level facility. So that sort of mapping of, you know, infrastructure in what we already have, what we can re-spruce, but then what are those key bottlenecks? Probably oxygen is not an issue in some areas. And for example, in probably Meghalaya, like, you know, Mr. Sampath was saying earlier, it's probably, you know, capacity building or something. But I think that granularity needs to come. Take an example of the tertiary centers. And this is something we've been discussing a lot in Kerala. So we have quite a few hospitals who are, you know, who do have beds. We have quite a few hospitals who have, you know, the infrastructure, the ventilators, but capacity of, you know, handling ARDS, acute respiratory distress, is not obviously something. So here what we're trying to do is actually build up, you know, a tele sort of network. So where we actually connect different ICUs, you know, through, you know, WhatsApp, Zooms, whatever. So people with a lot of experience can actually help support the management of patients without actually having to travel and be there. You know, so I think we need to move now towards actually mapping out exact requirements, mapping out, you know, exact, you know, capacities, looking how we can, you know, sort of link these. Just the last point, you know, I wanted to raise is that I think we need to now start looking at planning for 6 months to a year at least. And in that situation, we are going to be dealing with two situations. And I think, you know, what you've raised repeatedly is how are we going to manage the routine health requirements? So in Kerala, actually, we are now talking about dividing diseases into three, we are saying elective procedures and emergency procedures, and okay, those are very clear about, but we are now beginning to demarcate what we are calling a semi-emergent group of diseases. So for example, people on dialysis, people who are, you know, cancer chemotherapy, people who are chronic mental illness who require their medications, people who are on anti-epilepsy drugs, people who are on HIV, TB, okay? So all these individuals cannot be delayed. You know, you can't, you know, delay this for beyond maybe a week or so max, but I mean, even that is, you know, not acceptable. There are some essential public health functions, vaccination, antenatal care, access to abortion, access to reproductive health, access to contraception. Now, these are all things that, you know, very easily fall off the tables. But, you know, we can't afford to do that, not if we are looking at 6 months to a year. And I think, therefore, when we look again at infrastructure, we need to be very clear that our needs, so we may get the infrastructure to do this. We can build another hospital to look after the COVID, but where is our, human resource going to come from? And that's where I think we really need to, you know, think about, going beyond infrastructure to human resources to actually, to populate this infrastructure, to make this infrastructure, work. So are we going to look at, you know, centralized hospitals? Are we going to look at home care? Are we going to look at telemedicine? And these are the questions I think we really need to start asking, if we want to. And these are some of the questions that we are sort of discussing. So I'll just stop here then maybe we can take it up.
Yeah, just a quick 1 minute follow-up, because we might not get time for a second round. But, a lot of what you mentioned, and I think needs in general, there's always a criticism that there's not much interdepartmental convergence. You know, there are so many different departments: water, sanitation, energy, civil, panchayat, you mentioned training. So a lot of those. Do you see in these times there's a lot better interdepartmental convergence and cooperation?
Yeah, I think it'd be fair to say that is there. I think there is a sense of crisis, so everybody is, obviously, doing, wanting to pitch in and so on and so forth. But I do hope that, governments learn from this, the fact that, this is just such a critical aspect of day-to-day functioning. It's not just in times of COVID, but hopefully COVID will, begin to, help department see the importance of the other. And I mean, if there is one sort of silver lining, then I hope this is it.
Sure. Yeah. Thank you so much. I want to move to Dr. Ajit Kumar Sudke. Thank you so much for being here. I think Piramal Swasthya has run emergency services and ambulance services at a time like these. Just wanted to understand from you, how are you leveraging on those networks and what are some of the gaps and learnings that you're seeing on the ground, sir?
Yeah, so thank you for inviting me for this very important webinar, I think, and it's quite timely that we start discussing about how we are responding. Just one correction, that Swasthya does not run ambulances. We are into non-emergency care. So our focus is more on primary health care. So basically, Piramal Swasthya has been working across 21 states with a workforce of around 2,500 people on the ground. And as I said, our focus has been around primary health care. And we also leverage a lot of technology to deliver our services. So what actually has happened following the COVID-19 crisis is that we had to close down a lot of the work which we were doing in primary healthcare, which was around providing primary healthcare through community outreach programs, that is the mobile medical vans, and even through clinics, given that there were clear-cut instructions that all non-emergency care needs to be stopped. We are running around the health information helplines for different state governments across 8 states. And this has really proved to be one of the important dependable solutions for the different state governments. So what we've actually seen is that a 3 times increase in the number of calls which actually came to these health helplines. So we, as I said, in these 8 states, we manage around 350 health helpline seats, which are manned by more than 950 people actually managing those helplines. And so in February, before this COVID-19 pandemic, we were receiving around 7.6 lakh calls across these 8 states. And in March, once this pandemic actually started, the number of calls increased to around 21 lakhs. So there was a threefold increase in the number of calls which were coming. And so we really quickly had to mobilize our teams to ensure that the people who are handling these calls, we call them the health advisory officers, like how is their capacity built to handle these calls? So how do you really train such a huge workforce of around 1,000 people? So we leveraged technology for that. And thanks to the SELCO Foundation, so we had a partnership with them. We had the SELCO platform through which we were continuously training our people online. So that they're able to handle these calls well. Also, the other important thing which also happened was the government also looked at using these helplines in a more better way to track the patients who are coming. So just give you an example. You know, for example, in Assam, the health helpline and the Honorable Health Minister of Assam also tweeted about the support which this 104 helpline actually gave to the government when they started tracking, because as you all would be aware that there were no cases in Assam till the Delhi Nizamuddin fiasco happened and people started spreading out. And then so today I think we had around 28 odd cases in Assam, but with the help of the helplines they were really able to put the brakes on this entire spread. So and in Assam we are also running. So the other important thing which we also had to do was that what do you do with the staff which then had to sit back home from these MMUs or from the clinics? So we actually immediately sensitized them and built their capacities to provide services which the government warranted. For example, we run the MMU services in Assam, which is called the Sanjeevani services. So once the MMU was stopped, we utilized the teams in the Sanjeevani to actually accompany the doctors for the community visits. So they do home visits to the people who have actually come back from other states or from outside the country to ensure that they are home quarantined. So till date, we have around, the teams have visited more than 3,000 people. So they are regularly visiting these people. Then we are following up the people who are home quarantined. And as I said, we also started using the helpline to actually call up these the people. So the government actually gave us the list of numbers to us, which we actually then made those calls to them. And then to just give you an example, we received data of around 54,000 people and we had phone numbers of around 37,000 people. And in the first attempt, when we tried to contact them, we were able to reach around 30,500 of them. Then a second follow-up attempt was also done. So we were using these services so that we are able to get in touch with the people and ensure that they are quarantined, whether they are having any symptoms. Similarly, in Himachal Pradesh also, the state government is utilizing these 104 services to actually help track. So in Himachal, they've actually come up with a very interesting strategy. So they have categorized people into category A, B and C. So, for example, people having history of foreign travel or contact with any COVID-19 patient or patient who has actually come from a interstate, and those who have been put in a facility. And then they have a category which is called the seasonal flu patients. And so what happens is this entire list is given to our call center team, and the teams actually then keep on making these outbound calls, talk to the people, and then submit a report at the end of the day to the government as well. So this way, the helplines have really been very useful in supporting the government to contain this crisis. Another important thing, which I also heard from the other panelists, I think this COVID was a boon in sort for the telemedicine. Because as probably everybody is aware that there were a lot of discussions going on. There was a court case in the Mumbai High Court where they had actually put a stay on telemedicine. And so because the court wanted to actually have a framework before telemedicine was really rolled out across the country. But probably COVID provided that opportunity. And in Himachal Pradesh, so the only primary healthcare services which we are running now is in Himachal Pradesh, again with the government, where we have 75 telemedicine nodes. 50 of them are in health sub-centers and 25 are in PHCs or community health centers. And they are connected through the telemedicine to the hub, which is in Solan. And we have one specialist obstetrician sitting in Delhi, one specialist sitting in Hyderabad, and the physician sitting in Solan. But despite all other services being stopped down, the government of Himachal Pradesh continued to offer the services through this telemedicine, because all these 75 nodes are actually located so remotely that people hardly have any access to primary healthcare. And so this actually turned out to be a boon for many of the people and continuing these services. So probably you all are aware now that many of the large hospitals and all others have also started offering telemedicine services. But while this solution is really easy for people who are actually earning something, but then what happens to the poor people who can't afford to pay the private practitioners anything? So at this point in time, this model of the telemedicine which we are trying to run in Himachal Pradesh, where a GNM is posted in that health subcenter and she connects the patient to the specialist doctor or to the MBBS doctor in, sitting at the hub. I think this really has come up as a very important way to really handle future crisis in the coming years. And also to add, so I actually wanted to quote this, the last mile NGO, which is really working a lot on primary healthcare. The five key lessons which Ebola has really taught us to win against coronavirus, I think. So these five lessons are really crucial, which we really need to keep in mind. And probably India has been one of the countries which has really demonstrated that as well. The first point being, how do you really slow down the virus? Taking swift action, so which was followed during the Ebola crisis as well. So temporarily banning public gatherings, closing schools, asking residents to stay at home and all that. So probably that we have really been able to do effectively, because what the analysis really shows that this, if these actions during the Ebola crisis had been taken even 1 to 3 weeks later, we could have seen a 3 to 18-fold rise in the cases. And this is evident from what we are seeing in Italy or what we've seen in the US, wherever governments were really hesitant to put a complete lockdown, we've really seen a spike in the number of cases actually happening. The second important thing, which probably initially India lacked, was around testing. Test, test, and test. Because initially we were only focusing on the PCR testing. But now it's really great that last week, we have now come up with the antibody testing as well, which would probably help us to bump up the number of tests which actually happen. And I think engaging the private sector also is really critical. Important thing which probably would have to now happen moving ahead would be that how do you really test the people at their homes rather than having these people come all the way to the laboratory. So I think this is something which we'll have to start working on as we go ahead. The third most important point, and we all are aware of the deaths which happened in Indore, doctors dying or health workers dying, the deaths which have happened in the medical fraternity, even in Italy. I think even during Ebola, 1 out of 10 health workers died while treating Ebola. I think we really did not learn much from that incidence, but I think it's high time that we learn from that, because entire hospitals had to be locked down, doctors had to be put in quarantine only because we did not follow the PPE procedures well. So how do you really protect your healthcare workers, the doctors, the staff nurses and all that is really critical. The fourth point being repurposing the different arms of the government, including, for example, using the paramilitary, the military, and other resources available with the government in order to contain that. I think a lot of governments have started using that, and that is really important. I think the police are doing a fabulous job in ensuring that people stay back in homes. So it would be really important, given the thing which happened in West Bengal just yesterday. But the police really could not do much. So probably we would need the paramilitary to come in wherever required so that we are able to contain this. And the last point being, and which is really critical when we are really saying how do we respond, is the non-health area as to how do you really recover from the economic blow. So preparing that plan for recovery really becomes important. And what we have also seen is that a lot of funding coming from partners, they've all asked us to really look from the Ebola lens as well. The COVID lens as well. Like, how do you really repurpose? How do you really work in such a situation? For example, Piramal Swasthi is one of the organizations which is in the top 100 of the 100 and change global competition, which was floated by MacArthur. So this is the $100 million challenge. So they've asked all the top 100 organizations to really come back to them with how do you want to really work when this situation arises. Like, so this all then boils down to how agile or how resilient our health systems are. And the other important thing is the interconnectedness, because we really can't look at only from the health angle. Because as we all know, the reverse migration which has happened. the job losses which have actually happened. So there is a lot of interconnectedness whenever such a pandemic happens. And so that is why it becomes really crucial as to how do partners or different organizations working in different areas really come together and develop a cohesive plan where we can address all these problems. And Piramal Swasti in a way is trying to do their bit in this huge pandemic of COVID-19. So thank you.
Thanks a lot for that. I think it's a critical and very crucial service that's being provided. I want to quickly move to Mr. Sanjeev Jain, who's been patiently waiting. Thank you so much, Mr. Sanjeev Jain, for joining us. I'm so glad that you get to be, you know, almost the last speaker. I want to bring in a couple of others before Shweta gets her summarization and conclusion. But sir, you've been strengthening infrastructure and pushing for strengthening of infrastructure much before the pandemic. Just wanted to understand from you, like in the previous session, Dr. Ajit Kumar was saying, you know, the boon is that the government is now taking, you know, telemedicine seriously. So do you think that can also be pushed to taking other infrastructure, especially the sustainable infrastructure that you have been pushing more seriously to the government, and also has what you have already done, how much has it helped build the resilience during such a time in Chhattisgarh?
Thank you very much, Huda. Good afternoon to all panelists, participants, and thanks to SELCO Foundation to provide me opportunity to speak on the very timely discussion on health care infrastructure. As we have seen, health infrastructure is playing a very important role to combat COVID situation. In current situation, all the world are facing shortage of basic facilities, particularly in remote areas. As you know, electricity play a very important role for the last mile health delivery. And remotely located health centers suffer lack of electricity or a regular power supply. Interrupted power supply is a challenge in the health centers to provide the care services. As a nodal agency of MNRE, as a part of activity, we have successfully installed off-grid standalone solar power plant in about 1,200 health centers in the last 10 years and are being maintained by our robust operation and maintenance network to ensure the reliable, clean and green power for all type of energy needs for the health centers. Power is being used for their lighting purpose, for their basic needs, for the water supply, for the vaccine storage, and the medical, pathological, and other equipments operation, computers, communication, etc. It has been established that the solar is the solution to provide a reliable 24/7 power with energy security to provide the healthcare facilities. And as per the CWD report, it has been observed that the provision of the SPV power plant in the health centers helps the day-to-day activities and operation of the health staffs for the healthcare provision and securities. And it has increased the outdoor patients up to 50% to 80%. It has increased the delivery up to 100% in the health centers where the solar power plant is provided. And the lab services, now they are able to provide the infrastructure for the lab facilities and all diagnosis activities. Major is the staff retention. In most of the places, the staff building is there, staff is there, medical infrastructure is there, but due to lack of light, nobody will be there on the. So there is a light now, they are getting facilities for the electricity, and then they now can operate the TV and other equipment that they normally relay. So looking into this, our state government had realized the benefits of the solar in the health centers, and now it's an ongoing activity for the new health centers. In fact, scaling solar is a best option to meet the SDG target on a sustainable manner. In addition to this, we have provided the solar water heating systems to provide the hot water and steam for the sterilization purpose. So that they can use the other activities. In addition to this, recently in a aspirant districts of the Bastar region to provide the, to select the quarantine centers in a tribal hostels, the state district administration has selected the hostels which is already with the solar photovoltaic power plant. as you suggest, the quarantine centers for the next phase of the COVID to combat the new infrastructures. Recently, in fact, we are already using the prefabricated infrastructure, prefabricated control room for our battery room or control room. This will serve the definitely purpose of the quarantine center or isolation center with the solar photovoltaic power plant and water heating system with energy efficient equipment like fans, tube light and bulbs, etc. In most of the rural areas, the solar is the best option. In addition to this, Dr. Harish has already mentioned that the energy efficiency is the major concern in the electrical diagnosis appliances and medical appliances. We look into see the energy efficiency appliances, energy efficient appliances for the diagnosis to reduce the energy consumption, particularly in the health centers. With this, I would like to thanks again.
Sir, thank you so much, sir. Just a quick question. Right now, when you're pushing for solar water heaters and when you're pushing for energy system backups, are you being taken, we can't do that because we have other priorities right now? Or is it okay, that is a priority because we have an emergency need? How is it being received from the health departments, what you're trying to push?
In fact, solar water heating system, now it's a scheme, state scheme, the entire health centers is now being provided by the solar water heating systems. Now we are exploring possibilities of the concentrator to provide the steam to for sterilization purpose. In addition to this, now the next cool roof program is being implemented in the health centers. We are providing the high solar reflective index pant on the roof of the to reduce the temperature.
Thank you so much, sir. Thanks a lot. Before handing it over, I just want to thank all the panelists. I think we are out of time, but we will definitely reach out to each one of you for both for questions as well as answers moving forward. Just to summarize, I think we heard from, one is the COVID care centers that Mr. Sampath is looking at in Meghalaya and how they're helping balance the IPD, OPD. To the need to what Dr. Rakhal was saying on looking at things in a granular manner and need not everything having the same response, but can we actually granularize it at a time like this and actually provide what is needed. Both also talking about the need for decentralization, building the capacities of panchayat level, block level, district level, a lot of other inputs that both the panelists gave on the emergency services, the diagnostics appliances that are needed, as well as the crucial parts of ensuring that you have power and systems to actually allow for the heating, the sanitation, the water supply, etc. for these key services. Before I hand it over to you, Shweta, to conclude, I quickly want to bring in just 2-minute interventions we have with us Dr. Chintan from MIT. He's a professor of MIT, Dr. Chintan Vaishnav. Thank you so much for patiently being with us and listening through the whole thing. I think he has been working on systems design and really creating a systems model and a systems dynamic for looking at things at a regional, at a national level. Just wanted to quickly bring in your thoughts on the subject, as well as how should we be looking at health innovations moving forward? Dr. Chintan, thank you.
Sorry, Dr. Chintan, just 1 second. Huda, yeah. Dr. Ravi has also been able to join us now. Just wanted to let you know. Maybe we can have a quick intervention for him.
Sure.
Please, Dr.
Chintan. Okay, that's great. Thanks, Huda, and thank you for this very enlightening 3 hours together. So I'll be brief. So I think a number of people highlighted the need to really be granular and data driven and also very tailored to the regional and local needs, because I think there's a lot of knowledge in terms of both technology, modeling, etc., that's coming from best of the places. But I think we really need the adaptation of it to regional context. And that's the piece that I'm hoping to do here, even from a place like MIT, where a lot of people have engaged in solving local problems. Can we take those approaches and where they make sense, can we translate them to our context in India? And so in that sense, if there's anything that I could do for any of the panelists and people who have spoken or are engaged, I'll be happy to do that. I learned a lot from this conversation. And again, as specific as we can get, the better chance we have of protecting both life as well as the livelihoods of people, because we really can't be under a lockdown as a country for a very long time. So we will have to really be specific and strategically start opening things and while we save people. So great job. Over to you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Chintan. We have with us Dr. V. Ravi, a senior professor and head of neurovirology in NIMHANS. You're on the special task force of response to COVID-19 in Karnataka. Sir, if we can just get a minute or two of your thought before handing it over to Shweta. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for having me on the panel. I would just like to say that I come up with a background of public health virology. Two things I want to say is that testing is important. We need to expand testing. But what I want to make it very clear is we'll have to quickly put into action some plans on every state or every region using the data of testing for planning interventions. One of the weak links I have seen in my 30 years of public life is a lot of data generated, but nobody actually critically reviews this data for planning for interventions. Number two, COVID has given us a great opportunity to do excellent mapping, which I think should be continued beyond COVID, for mapping labs to healthcare facilities. If we don't do that, it will be very chaotic. In Karnataka, we have sat for last 4 days and we have mapped districts and healthcare facilities to the nearest labs so that you use the limited resources that we have. You can't have a lab at every place. So we need to make sure that all of us are disciplined enough to reach out to the lab that has been allocated to us and avail the facility. And as I said, using the test results, analyzing it, and planning for intervention. That's all I have. Thank you very much.
Thanks so much, sir. It was great to hear from you. Glad you could join in. Shweta, with that, over to you to summarize and conclude. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Huda. And I think thanks to all the participants for this really rich conversation that we've had today. I think one thing that I sort of realized, which we have been sort of reading also about, that, you know, we as a society were not normal before COVID. And so when people say what would be the new normal, I think we should recognize the abnormality that we had earlier in terms of our divides of class and caste, and sort of fix that going forward. And COVID has in a way given us shown the mirror as to where we are lacking as a society and how do we rebuild ourselves and our society in terms of going forward. And the principles that I sort of gathered from all the different approaches and different speakers that have shared their experience today is that we have to build going forward rooted in justice and dignity. These are the two key principles that we need to start looking at when we are looking at a world post-COVID. And as Dr. Reddy said in the beginning, that, you know, empathy and efficiency would be something that we need to take forward. We're seeing a lot of innovation, which is phenomenal, because this crisis has led to a lot of discussion around affordable technology, technology that sort of is low cost, technology that is sustainable. I think we need to start investing and encouraging more of that. We need to definitely take a systems approach to the health issue. I mean, we need to acknowledge the interconnectedness that is there between environment, society, and economics. I mean, we are seeing what is popularly now being said, that COVID is sort of a trailer of what climate change disasters are going to bring to us in future. And this is an opportunity to learn, adapt, at the same time invest invest in universal healthcare, invest in, you know, robust disease surveillance programs, invest in protecting our healthcare workforce. Dr. Thomas mentioned that it's very important that there's one big lesson that we need to take from here. Is that we have to destigmatize the disease itself. We need to focus on health force safety, and in general, not let this disease become a weapon for a few, for their political gains or any other gains. We need to sort of start looking at equity and equality. I think one very critical issue that came forward, which Dr. Ravikant mentioned and some of the other speakers also mentioned, was the fact that we're so focused on COVID-related interventions that somewhere the non-COVID-related health issues are getting somewhat ignored, and we cannot afford to let that happen. It's not just about disruptions of health services like immunization or reproductive care or TB care, which we are now seeing in the media reports coming out of Impact, but also given the fact that we are entering into the summers and heat stress and heat-related stress issues will become of paramount importance. There would be, in the monsoons, situations of heavy rainfalls or floods. So I think we need to start sort of thinking about going forward, also factoring in these sort of situations and start working or preparing ourselves in advance. And again, invest in a resilient health system that sort of is able to take care of these kind of more and more calamities that unfortunately we would be seeing because of climate change. Couple of other things that sort of was key to me from especially from the Voices from the Field session was that it's very important to have a public education and awareness. Well-informed people take well-informed decisions. And I think it's of paramount importance, and this is what I learned from session from Dr. Sudarshan and Dr. Matthew Abraham, is the crucial role of healthcare leadership that is being exhibited at community level, at which different case studies also sort of showed us. Healthcare spokesperson are the most trusted spokesperson. They are providing the right information, and with that, people are getting motivated and coming forward to participate and do their bit. And this is, I think, for me, overall, from the experiences shared today, it's a very interesting perspective to show that there can be nuanced response to the crisis. And this is just exhibited that going forward, certain principles that we have adopted and which have become successful in handling the situation in different states or at different organization levels, they need to be amplified and highlighted as our overall response as a society to this pandemic and any crisis that comes in future.
Thank you so much. Thanks a lot, Shweta, for summarizing that. I think that was brilliantly done for 3 hours of summary that you provided. Thanks so much for all the participants and attendees for joining us. Please send us your feedback as well as a lot of your questions. There were a lot of connections during this, and we will make that soon after this webinar is ended. I believe a lot of good connections can be forged and good cross-learning also can be taken forward. So thank you so much to all the panelists, especially taking time out from your very, very precious schedules at this time. Thank you. Bye, everyone. Take care. Be safe.
Thank you.